Well, I'd like to welcome everyone to the 2020 virtual University of Pennsylvania football season. My name is Matt Leon, and I'd like to welcome you to today's broadcast, Quakers taking on Navy, October 18th, 1986. It was a rousing 30-26 win for Penn in Annapolis. Quakers improving to 5-0 en route to a perfect 10-0 season and an Ivy League title. Before we get started, want to let you know that the virtual Penn football season is presented by Independence Blue Cross and Steam Fitters, Local Union 420.
It has been made, and Navy has won the toss. Because there is a pretty good stiff wind coming in from the north, Navy has elected to defend the goal line and take the wind here in this first quarter. So Penn will receive the football, which means that the Penn offense will be out there now. There is Chris Flynn, number 27, and Jim Bruni, the two receivers. Offensively, this is the way they will go. Krochickia, the quarterback, Lorano, the fullback, Rich Camizio, the tailback, then Rob Williams and Ken Saunders, the wideouts, and Brent Novoselski will be the tight end. Up front, Ernst, Wilkins, Bonato, Panzini, and Peterson. Not a particularly big front line, certainly not as big as Navy, but rather quick. Defensively, for the Naval Academy, Cook, Plants, Blazes, Van Horn, and Van Hulzen up front. Then Tom Doman, who was our player of the game for Navy last week against Air Force, along with Vince McBeth. And in the secondary, Heron, Stefanon, Kiefer, and Mark Furley. The officials for today's game, you'll laugh at this, particularly if we were on the Halloween weekend. The referee is Vincent Price today. The umpire, Ronald Klages. The linesman, Sanford Rivers. The line judge, Paul Tye. The field judge is Walter Lucas. The back judge, Nicholas Trainer. And here is Bill Byrne, who hopes Bud Wilkinson to have a better day today than he did a week ago, the quarterback of Navy.
Well, it was an almost impossible to throw the misfortune to throw five interceptions, and of course that's one of the reasons that it was such a one-sided score. But with these conditions and with the class athlete that Burns is, he's hit 61 of 116 passes. That's 52% so far this year. So he is a solid, solid football player. Only needs to complete 75 more yards to become the all-time leading passer in Navy history.
Those bright yellow caps that you see that the brigade is wearing today, and a great big N on top, and then it says, "Shake the Quakers." So that's a little stunt that they pulled today. Coming into this game today, Pennsylvania is undefeated, 4-0, leading the Ivy League. Navy is 3-2. Last meeting, as I mentioned, was in 1960. And this is probably one of the closest long series rivalries in the history of college football. Look at that, 21-20-4. With Penn holding that one game edge, so the midshipmen are hoping that they can win today. It's kind of a historical note, really, because this is the first visit the Quakers have made, can you believe this, to Annapolis since 1915? All of the other games were played in Philadelphia. Now we're set to go. Bob Sunderland, number 9, will kick off. And the deep men, as I mentioned, are Bruni and Chris Flynn. Flynn, I think, is a name that you're going to hear a lot today. Where's number 27? Really a flashy runner, and although he is on the depth roster, number 2 to Camizio, I think you'll see him in the lineup a lot. After all, he's leading the Ivy League in rushing. High kick coming down to Flynn, 15, 20, and is belted at the 27-yard line. So, it'll be Krochickia, Camizio, Lorano, and Saunders in the backfield. Up front, Cook, Plants, Blazes, Van Horn, and Van Hulzen, McBeth, and Doman, the linebackers, Stefanon, Kiefer, Furley, and Harris.
Penn uses a great variety of formations. They'll be in two tight ends, sometimes three tight ends in the game. Their basic set, however, is the two wideout flankers, as you can see.
Rob Williams split out to the left, a long way out. Deep man, there's Camizio, and he rips off. Nice game. Good six.
And the blocking in the offensive line was just outstanding. Camizio is averaging 5.7 yards a try as we see the play again. See the handoff. He squares his shoulders, leans forward, accelerates beautifully as he breaks through the line of scrimmage and is stopped by the linebacker and the secondary after a good game.
fumble picked up immediately by Joe Lorano, the fullback, who had the ball bobbled out of his arms. So that brings a no gainer up there for them. Third down.
And that's a tough thing to have happen when you mix it up yourself instead of having...
Being the more stringent of the two penalties took precedence. And that means that it was the 15-yard penalty back to the 35, and now it comes to the 37. Tom Doman on the stop, and it's third down and a big mount to gain.
Tough situation for any offensive football team.
23 yards away from the first down. Long count by Krochikia, and looks to the sidelines. Doman missed him. The pass is completed to Rob Andrews, but it was not enough for the first down. About 4 yards short, Greg Stefanon covering on the play.
Krochikia rolls out very effectively and has the option to pass run on these rollouts. See him sprinting to the right, gets turned upfield, finds Andrews open, hits him right at the sidelines. Excellent execution on the play, but short of the first down.
So the punter has come into the lineup, Dave Fosnacht, 37-yard average. And he ought to be able to put Navy in a pretty good hole here. It's against the wind. The ball will be held up a little bit. And Furley calls for the fair catch. Ooh, that was close. At the 13-yard line. So the midshipmen now will get an opportunity to see if their offense can function on a good day rather than a snowy field as it was a week ago. Back in just a moment. Here's the offense for the midshipmen. Bill Byrne, the senior quarterback. Chuck Smith, who is now third in the nation in all-purpose running, rushing, and scoring. Curtis Brown starting today in place of the injured Chuck McKenna at fullback. Tony Hollinger, Mike Ray, and John Sniffen. And I think we may see a change there, Bud, because there had been some talk about two tight ends. Let's check.
I think they'll use that formation a great deal during the day.
First down for the midshipmen. No score, first quarter. Here's Chuck Smith. Oh, it's deja vu.
Like last week.
So we went out there. I remember that first drive. We're on D. They're standing around the pile, and we're getting to the pile. And I remember smacking up one of those big offensive linemen right under his chin on the first or second play, just sort of announcing, hey, we're all here and we're all going to be in your face all day. And they had no idea what hit them.
No gain. Defensively, it's Lista, Desir, and Sebastianelli in that three-man front. Then the outside linebackers are Jeff Fortner and Hippensteel. The inside men are McConnell and Inske. And then in the secondary, Heinz, Tom Flynn, no relation to Chris, Don Wilson, and James Fangmeyer.
This Penn team has not allowed a point in the first half of any game played thus far this season.
Oh, that's kind of a remarkable statistic. Second and 10, and here is Byrne. A little one over the middle, complete to Sniffen, the tight end, and he gets it up to the 26-yard line. And he's belted by Donald Wilson, number 21.
Excellent hit, but fine execution. Sniffen was wide open as he came out late. Byrne drops back. A little bit of a running fake. Smith sets, looks downfield. Sees Sniffen wide open coming across the field. No one's close. But as he turns upfield, he really does get hammered by the last Penn defensive man.
The men are ready. First down. Gain of 13 on the play on the 25-yard line. Nice block by the tight end and going through the line very quickly from that right halfback spot. Actually, it was Curtis Brown who carried it, but the tight end, John Sniffen, was the one who had it through.
It's another thing that Navy expects to do today, run far more traps than they have previously. Brown is a great ball carrier. He's averaging 5.6 yards per carry.
Mike Ray has gone in. Here comes Chuck Smith. He just looks to me, Bud, as if he is very determined today. Not that he isn't always, but he had a frustrating 40-yard afternoon a week ago.
He had 17 carries to make those 40 yards, but that last picture was a good example of the great acceleration he has and the speed he has and how he can turn his body just to slide through the very, very narrow openings to pick up yards that most backs would not make.
First down. It's the second one in a row for the midshipmen as they've taken this punt now from Pennsylvania and have moved it out to the 38-yard line from their own 13. No score. We've got 10 minutes and 30 seconds to go here in this first quarter.
Penn feels very strongly that they need to stay in the game, prove for the first half that they are as good a football team as Navy, and they can accomplish that. They feel that the closer they get to the fourth quarter, the more their players will believe that, yeah, we're good enough as an Ivy League team to beat Navy.
Byrne keeps on the bootleg. Skipping is out of bounds at the 43-yard line of Pennsylvania.
Very good pass protection on the play.
Yeah, watch this block here.
Little running flake again, misdirection. Byrne gets out. There was that great block. And Sniffen again comes across the field, has got just speed enough to outrun the linebacker, open for the first down.
That, by the way, was Greg Gephardt, who started today at left tackle in place of George Williams, who made the block. Chuck Smith stopped by Fortner after gaining about two.
Byrne made a good fake that time. Looked as though he may or may not give the ball to Smith. Of course he did, but that will set up the play action pass.
So we've had the first penetration of the ball game, Navy in Penn territory, and here's Byrne to pass. To the sideline to Troy Saunders, and he's got it out of bounds at the 23-yard line. Donald Wilson right on him, but Saunders, who caught a beauty for 55 yards against Dartmouth a couple of weeks ago, now puts Navy in a threatening position. 21-yard gain on the play.
See the crossing breakout, and Saunders is right on the receiving end as Byrne hits him squarely in the numbers.
So it's first down on the 23-yard line as Saunders goes out wide to the left. And here is Sniffen leading through the hole, and Chuck Smith follows him to the 20-yard line. A gain of about 2-3 on the play. McConnell, the leading tackler for Penn, makes the stop along with Dexter Dazier.
Penn defense geared to play against the run. They have not yet been able to get to the passer, force Byrne to hurry any throws, and the Navy passing attack has been very acceptable. They've made 50 yards already throwing the football. 25 more, and he's broken the record.
9 minutes to go, first quarter, and Navy threatening here. Been a good drive. Well, I'll tell you one thing, they are keying on Smith just as Air Force did a week ago, giving him no quarter.
The Penn defense has been very tough against the running attack all of the time, and you can see that they do get control of the line of scrimmage, even against the big, big Navy offensive line. Hard hitting, and they're stopping the runs that effectively. Usually some of the passes are open, which has been the case for Navy thus far.
Watch number 59, that's A.J. Sebastianelli. He was in on the last tackle. Over the middle, it's perfect to Hollinger. Touchdown! Hollinger got a step and a half on his man, and that brings the cannon out and the midshipmen to their feet.
Beautifully executed play. Almost jumped on the defensive line. Byrne sets. Finds Hollinger coming across the field, wide open. And he's into the end zone for the score. I don't believe that Byrne has missed a pass yet.
And the extra point is up and good by Fandukas. And it is 7-0 in favor of Navy. And that, of course, is a cheering note for the midshipmen. Now this is a historic note for Tony Hollinger, but his first touchdown.
And Byrne drops back. He was pressured just a little bit, but had plenty of time to, again, hit Hollinger on the crossing pattern. He was tackled at the goal line, but took the ball into the end zone for the score.
And it must be very, very a happy note for Hollinger, because he's a Philadelphia boy.
And Burns completed every pass he's thrown thus far.
And the kickoff will be handled by Sunderland. High kick going over to Chris Flynn at the 20. He's dangerous. Out to the 35, 36-yard line. Oh, you have the feeling, Bud, with watching him run, that he could go any moment.
I think he can. He's got an 8-yard average. And if you've got an 8-yard average, you are a great running back. Fine drive by Navy. 10 plays, 86 yards, 4 minutes and 19 seconds. And, the passing by Burns was just sensational.
Rochicki on a long count. Gives it off to Camizio, goes outside, gets five and out of bounds.
Good ball carrier. I know that Penn is thinking Navy didn't stop us the first time. We stopped ourselves with a penalty. That's what coaches are always worrying about.
This is the 46th game in this series, believe it or not, that started in 1888. Only 100 years ago. Second and six. Then trailing 7-0 first quarter. Again, the short pump, and there's nobody there. The receiver, Rob Andrews, fell down at the 40-yard line.
Again, the pump fake and the effort to go deep. The coaching staff felt that Navy was vulnerable to that quick short fake and then throw the ball deep. Thus far, they were burned once when Furley interfered. The last time when the receiver fell down, there's just no way to make a judgment about the play.
So it's third down. Ball on the 40-yard line up Penn. Navy leading 7-0. First quarter, 7:58 to go.
Checking signals and audible.
Yeah, Navy reacting to it, dancing around, goofing up. There's a penalty marker down, but as you saw, John Fuller reached up and swatted the ball, number 40. But there was a marker down on the play. Illegal motion by the offense. But there's a case where if they take the down, it would make it a fourth down situation.
And I think that's what they'll do, Bill. Penn likes to audible, and when you are audibling, it's a little bit difficult always for every player to hear and to also maintain their poise and not jump offside or get a procedural penalty.
And Vince McBeth makes the decision. We will take the down. Gary Tranquil. That wasn't Gary, as a matter of fact. He's got too much air. Here's the punt by Fosnock, taken by Furley. And he gets a couple of yards, squeezed out of it, up to about the 29-yard line. Well, the midshipmen have proven they can move the football. They went 86 yards the last time they had it. They'll take over when we come back. Bill Fleming, Bud Wilkinson, and Rick Forzano back at the Navy Marine Corps Memorial Stadium here in Annapolis.
This is the first time, Bill, that Penn has been behind this season. I'm sure they were not that confident they would be able to maintain that unscored on in the first half string, but it's a good defense. Their pass defense has just been a step slow.
Yeah, there seems to be a very vulnerable spot over the middle that is being exploited by the midshipmen. First down on the 28-yard line. Hollinger in motion. Here's Chuck Smith. Can't turn the corner, so he decides to head upfield. Rick Inskeep making the stop.
Penn is a very physical defensive football team. As you can see, every player is combative and is attacking all of the time.
So Mike Ray comes out. Troy Sanders goes in. And Vernon Wallace has made his appearance as a wideout. So Bill Byrne, who has been perfect in throwing today, is back to throw once again. Once more, over the middle, and it is not caught by Chuck Smith. Having to run backwards, Rick Inskeep right on it. Another Rick is on the field. This one is our Rick Forzano.
Bill, it looks like to me that the Pennsylvania cornerbacks are playing what I call an inside technique, and they are giving the outside patterns to the Navy receivers, so I would look for Navy to throw the ball to the down and outs on the wide receiver patterns.
Well, that's kind of technical, but how would you interpret it?
Well, it's covering on the inside. The outside is open. That's the easiest way to do it, and very clear.
Third down and seven. There he is in the middle. It is intercepted right into the arms of Jeff Fortna. And there are markers all over the field. Jeff Fortna is the left outside linebacker, a senior from Fredericksburg, Pennsylvania.
And he's supposed to be the best linebacker in the Ivy League, Bill. I think that's a consensus opinion.
Also, a Navy player was hurt on the play, and he is kneeling at the 32-yard line. It's Tim Brunn, offensive left guard, being helped to the sidelines.
15 yards, first down.
A block below the knees, cost him 15. The penalties have really hurt the Quakers here.
So far, they surely have, but it's first and 10 and good field position following the interception. We see the interceptor Fortner moving downfield on the replay.
Big break for the Quakers. Handed off to Camizio. He wants to prove to Chuck Smith he can run just as hard. Tripped up there by John Fuller and Vince McBeth. Well, for the first time, the ball is over on the Navy side of the 50. Camizio goes out, and we're going to see Chris Flynn. It's the first time we will have seen him in the lineup other than kickoff returns. Number 27.
Different type runner, a little more darting, breaking.
You can see that. Cuts back and falls forward to about the 46-yard line. Hit by Mark Furley.
It's a great 1-2 punch. Camizio is more of a power runner, Flynn a darting runner, and they play about equal time.
As we mentioned to you, that's Brunn, who was taken off the field. We're taking a look at him. His knee.
Hate to lose anybody.
Third down, three on the 46 of Navy. Penn trailing here, 7-0 in the first quarter. Camizio back in, and he just grinds it for a first down. Even though he had the Navy tacklers right on his back, and he gets it down to the 42-yard line. Well, it's nice to be able to alternate Camizio and Flynn.
But he's fresh off the time, and both of them equally dangerous.
Yeah, and I think the point you make is good, too. They're so dissimilar in styles in running that the defense can't gear one for the other. And now Camizio goes out, and Flynn is in. On the first down, on the 42.5-yard line. Navy leading, 5:27 to go in the first quarter. The score is 7-0 after a nice, sustained 4-minute drive by the midshipmen. Flynn outside tries to hurdle a man, and there's no way to do it.
And there's no place to run. They all look the same. Doesn't matter how much potential skill a back has. If the line has not done their job, everybody looks alike.
Curtis Irby was the one who made the stop, number 35. Second down. There's Camizio, and he finds a little bit of an opening at the 38-yard line. He's dropped by Van Hulzen. Take a check on the scores. Army and Holy Cross are playing today, and in the second quarter, Army is leading by 3. And Notre Dame up on Air Force, 17-3 in the third quarter. Florida over Rutgers, 3-0 in the first. And Boston College, 21-7 over Louisville. Camizio and Flynn are in the lineup at the same time. And nobody back, but
trips formation. All four wide receivers ready to go down the field quickly. And they hit it.
Kenny Saunders.
And Saunders breaking to the outside. And that's what Rick was talking about. Outside pattern open. And a big, big first down. Good field position now for the Quakers.
Just inside the 30. Pennsylvania trailing here. 7-0, but threatening in the first quarter. 4 minutes to go. First man through is Lozano, the fullback. And he gets a good 5 yards before Vince McBeth, number 19, brings him down.
And a beautiful shot block by Mancini. Moreno has averaged 5 yards per try, so this is a very explosive backfield.
Tell you one thing, they certainly mix it up. We've seen about six different formations already in the first quarter.
And they're adjusting which wide receiver is eligible all of the time. Wingback, tight end, wingback.
That's Novoselsky trotting around there to confuse the defense. Nice hole for Chris Flynn, but Blazes, Enoch Blazes, number 75, brings him down. Injury report, Rick?
Maybe bruised right knee, will probably sit out the first half, maybe back the second half. That's from Red Romo, the trainer.
Rick, we only got part of that. What was the name?
Tim Brunn, the young man that went out with a knee injury just a moment ago. Just a bruised right knee, will hold him out the first half at least.
Third down and three. Ball on the 27-yard line, 23-yard line. Check that.
Trip wide receivers again. No running back.
And good protection. Down the middle, and it is Camizio. There was a penalty marker, however, down as Mark Furley was covering on the play. Camizio couldn't hold it. There's a marker down at the line of scrimmage, which leads us to believe it may have been offensive holding.
All right, Captain. We've got a 10-yard penalty. If you take the penalty, it's going to be third down and 13. If you take the play, it's going to be fourth and three.
That's a tough decision. And I think you look to the bench now to decide, what does the coach want? And let's take that yardage.
So it was a holding penalty, offensive holding against Penn. And the Quakers have really been hurt.
Holding. Third down.
And you can see the holding penalty, number 68.
And Zena.
Pass is a little bit underthrown.
So it's third down. And about 13. Kochikia on the screen pass. He has Camizio down to about the 24-yard line.
He stumbled just a little bit as the turf went out from under him as he tried to make his break. Had he not stumbled, he might have picked up the first down on the play. Take a look at it again. It's the screen pass setup. Kochikia dropping back, setting. Here comes the rush. He drops the ball over the rush to Camizio. He breaks upfield, and now you can see him just cleats kind of went out from under him as he tripped. His blocker was working in front of him.
And Jim Grass has gone in to try this field goal of 42 yards out of the hold of Dan McNally. Grass, one field goal in three attempts this year. This one wobbles up there, and it's good. It just did get over like a wounded bird. It just made it inside the left upright and just over the crossbar. So Pennsylvania has three, and Navy has seven. Looks like they may need a little extra ammunition against these Quakers.
Well, getting the 3 points did just an inestimable amount of good for the morale of this Penn team. They felt they were as good as Navy, but you have to be in the game, and they've gotten through almost the total first quarter, 7-3, so they're very much in it, and they're gaining confidence every time the ball is snapped.
Yeah, and remember, too, that in the second quarter, Penn will get the win. And it's fairly stiff. It's coming in from the open end here, the north end of the Navy Marine Corps Memorial Stadium. This kick will be by Jim Grass into the wind. He'll probably try to keep it as low as he possibly can. Kicks it over toward the sidelines. And it's taken by Chuck Smith. He stepped out of bounds at the 19-yard line.
I'm not sure that he should have handled that kick. It was going to go out of bounds. kicking again into the wind. We have to get penalty, get better field position as we watch the play again. You can see the ball hit the ground. It comes right up with a perfect bounce to Smith, but he doesn't realize how close he is to the sidelines, and he steps out of bounds. The scoring drive following the interception was 10 plays, only 29 yards, 5 minutes and 1 second. So it took him a long time, a lot of plays.
That 42 yards was a career long for Jim Brett. Misdirection play. Chuck Smith tries to get outside, and once again, Inske, the senior from Coral Gables, Florida, number 37, brings him down. Good play.
And that was very close. He was almost going to break into the clear, and Smith has got the speed that, if that happens, deep, deep trouble for the defense.
Hollinger, who has scored Navy's only touchdown, goes in the lineup. Mike Ray comes out. Kevin Voss, the tight end, comes out. Sniffett is in along with Saunders. We keep you up to date on those receivers because they keep shuttling them in and out, and any one could go at any moment, if you know, for a long gain or a touchdown. Sebastianelli in on the stop there. Chuck Smith at the bottom.
Penn uses three basic defensive alignments. They're, that time we're in a basic 3-2 set in the middle. Sometimes they have what looks like a split 6-6 set, and sometimes they line up 6 men on the line of scrimmage head-to-head across the line of scrimmage with the offensive player, and that's a very tough defense to run against.
Third down and two. 41 seconds to go in this first quarter. Navy leading 7-3 in a tight ball game. Chuck Smith tries to go through, bangs heads. Oh, there's the extra effort that brought the first down. Looked like a billy goat.
Great balance. He was able to withstand the blow of the tackler, stop momentarily, but then accelerate again, make the yardage. See how hard he's hit. Toss back from Byrne, and bingo, he's really hit solidly. Tackler did not get his arms around him. You've got to get your arms around Smith if you're going to make the tackle.
And Byrne, good faking, has time. Spins it to the sideline. It is caught. Troy Saunders, right in front of the Navy bench, gets it to the 43-yard line.
And this enables Byrne to break the academy record for career yards passing. 12-yard gain on the play.
So it's first down on the 43-yard line. We're into the final 12 seconds of this first half. That's first quarter, I should say. Sniffett goes back after starting in motion. Smith now gets outside and gets to midfield and into Penn territory before James Fangmeyer has to come up and knock him down.
And he got a great block by Brown to spring him when it appeared there was not much daylight.
And that is
the
end
toss
of the
back. And Brown does a marvelous job of hooking his man in that enabled Smith to turn upfield and pick up the big game.
And so, Navy leads Pennsylvania by the score of 7-3 at the end of one quarter of play. And we'll be back in just a moment.
Our beloved university is facing a landscape that we've never seen before. Empty classrooms, weight rooms, dormitories, dining halls, and arenas. From Shear Pool to the Palestra, Penn Athletics is in uncharted territory. Our coaches and student athletes are navigating these challenges, but they're looking to you and to me for our leadership, our community, and our support.
In the face of monumental adversity, our student athletes have responded with resilience, positivity, and strength. The world needs courageous leaders, teammates, and champions. Our student athletes are ready to take on this call. When we do return to play, we will be ready to win. It is our job to ensure our student athletes will be able to grow, compete, and win for years and years to come, be it with your volunteer leadership, as part of our mentoring and advisory network, or with your financial resources. You are needed now more than ever. The next era of Penn Athletics has arrived. With your help, we can set the future in motion.
By receiving an incredible academic and athletic experience at Penn,
I'm investing in myself and in my future. Win the Weight is about seeing adversity, not as an obstacle, but as an opportunity. I have been in awe of the support by our amazing alumni, parents, and friends during this time. In the face of our current adversity, we see an opportunity to come together as a team and a community. We will help one another maintain a clear focus on the ultimate goals and a clear purpose as we pursue excellence on and off the court. With your investment, we'll become even stronger in the future and we'll hang even more banners in the Palestra. You can set the future in motion by supporting Penn Athletics today.
Penn invests in its
Well, I'd like to welcome everyone to the 2020 virtual. Well, I'd like to welcome everyone to the 20.
Penn Athletics continues
to strengthen their
these after graduation. Help us set the future in motion by investing in Penn Athletics during these most difficult times.
Well, I'd like to welcome everyone to the 2020
Leadership Academy. Our advancements in mental health is after graduation.
And through the halls, we'll
be ready.
Momentum is something we work
during these most difficult times.
Ready to begin this second quarter of play with the ball on the 49-yard line of Pennsylvania. Navy in possession with the second down coming up and about two. And through the hole squeezes Curtis Brown behind the block of John Sniffen, and he gets the first down.
Not much. That's enough yardage. But the key factor, make the first down. If Penn can strengthen their pass defense, get a little more pressure on Byrne, a little better coverage. They did get the interception the last time he put it up, so maybe they're getting the confidence they need in their pass defense.
The only touchdown in this game was scored on a pass to Tony Hollinger from Bill Byrne in the first quarter. And Byrne on a nice bootleg. Makes it short and throws it away. You know, Sebastianelli played that well, number 59 of Pennsylvania. He actually was handling two men in there and I think caused some frustration to Byrne. There he is. By the way, he has a kind of a Boz haircut. And I think his nickname is the Barber.
Yeah, I think so. I saw him yesterday in practice, and it kind of looks like a mohawk. Byrne was able to execute the bootleg fake very well, but no receiver turned up open.
Chuck Smith comes outside. Look how fast he is. Pretty close first quarter, bud.
Yes, it was. If you take the penalties out, it would be a much closer set of statistics. The total yards, maybe ahead, and the penalty factors, you can see how drastic they were against Penn, comparatively speaking.
We'll look at this third leading rusher in the nation, Chuck Smith, just a junior. Has 40 yards today so far, and that now is well to 44 after a four-yard gain. So in the quarter and 1 minute, he has surpassed what he did all of the entire game last week.
And a little bit of different footing also, which certainly helps him.
Amen to that. This telecast is an exclusive presentation of the Freedom Sports Network. Any reproduction or rebroadcast without the express written consent of the Freedom Sports Network is strictly prohibited. First down on the 33-yard line. Navy protecting a four-point lead here in the second quarter. Byrne looks to Sniffen, then comes back this side to Smith, who makes a good catch at the 29-yard line, a gain of about five on the play. Scooped it up.
It was a great reception. The ball was badly, badly underthrown. I don't know whether Byrne slipped. Take a look at it. See, he delivered the ball. And Smith was really quite open on the play. The ball was so badly underthrown, he had to reach down, did make the reception, but had to go to the ground as he made the catch.
And Smith darts through that small opening, gets it down to about the 25, 24-yard line, 2 yards short of the first down. Lista and McConnell making the stop, 94 and 45.
If you get just a standoff with the offensive and defensive lines, Smith is going to make 4 or 5 yards of the play because he's got that balance and quick acceleration.
So about a yard to go.
As far as the pom-poms.
Third down. 12:53 to go, first half. Smith lining up behind Curtis Brown. Follows him through, and he gets the first down.
Pretty good running fake that time. As Smith took the ball, Byrne went back, and again, he's doing a good job of setting up the play-action pass where he's going to fake to Smith and keep the ball, go back and throw downfield. Penn, of course, is thinking, let's get a turnover. Let's get a turnover.
First down on the 23-yard line. Navy leading Penn, 7-3, second quarter. Smith once again. Not much room to run. Good tackle. Brad Hippensteel.
Coming up at halftime, we will be taking a look at last week's dramatic highlights of the Army-Tennessee game. What a game that was, as Army upset the Volunteers during that last minute of play. I'll tell you what, you'll see one of the best blocked punts in all of college football this season.
You can make that happen in the closing moments of the game and then make a touchdown rather than have it bounce for a safety. You've really accomplished something that is rare.
Billy, number 22 you saw there a moment ago munching on the grass, is eternally grateful that they never put the artificial turf in here. Second down, about 7. Ball in the 20. Hearn took no chances that time. He saw the incoming enemy and fired it as hard as he could, but as you saw, it was way over the head of the intended receiver.
And yeah, that was the first time that Penn has come with the blitz. It was a cornerback blitz. Flynn was wide open, coming in free. Hearn wisely got rid of the ball before he was sacked.
Brown and Cornell are playing today, Harvard and Dartmouth and Columbia and Yale, so from the Ivy League, Harvard on top and Yale on top. Third down, and Byrne to pass once more. Soft one just off the fingertips of Mike Ray. A little tentative on that one.
I don't think he quite decided how soon he wanted to get rid of the ball, and should he let his receiver go a little bit further or go now? And that indecision, Bill, as you pointed out, caused the ball just to sort of flutter out there.
Bob Mish has gone into hold, and Fundukas will try this field goal. This will be about 37 yards into the wind. Fundukas has a fairly strong leg, though. Now he's got plenty of it. And it is good. So Ted Fundukas makes his first field goal. And the score is now Navy 10, Penn 3. Well, the Plebes are anxious to do 10 here, giving Navy a 7-point lead. Rick Forzano has something.
Bill, I was just behind the Pennsylvania... Pennsylvania bench, and I believe that field goal has just given Pennsylvania a little bit more confidence that they can see this Navy football team. And one other thing, Pennsylvania brought 103 players and have them all dressed, so they're going to try to outnumber Navy, if nothing else.
You mean to tell me the guy is going to wear 101, 102,
103? He'll wear anything if he can dress for a varsity football game.
Here's the kick by Sunderland, Highland. And once again, Chris Flynn at the 17. You really got to belt him. He wiggles away from people. Look at that.
Great determination and also great balance.
What a set of legs.
And the Navy scoring drive, 16 plays, moved 62 yards. It's a good drive, 5 minutes and 27 seconds to the field goal.
Yeah, all of the scoring drives have been either 4 minutes or longer. Nothing quick has happened. I believe, to follow up on what Rick said about 100 and some players, I believe the Ivy League has a restriction. You can only take, 50 or 60, whatever it is. So this not being an Ivy League game, it gives Penn an opportunity to take as many as they can. And it's the one game a year that they can do that. Camizio getting a couple of yards up to about the 34-yard line.
And it's a great thing for the squad morale. When everybody gets to come on a trip, everybody feels closer, more a part of the total action.
10-3 is the score. We have 10 minutes and 52 seconds to go in this first half.
And Penn can avoid the penalties, Bill. I think they can move the football.
Ochikia fires it in there. It is complete to Novoselski, the tight end. You know, it's funny, but the Pennsylvania touchdown passes have all been to tight ends this year.
Well, their tight ends are excellent football players, and tight ends really are the most overlooked receivers because most defenses are geared to handle the wide receivers. Penn uses them very wisely and very well.
Well, it's going to hurt them here, though, because there's another holding penalty against the Quakers.
And the penalties have just killed Penn. It's their fifth penalty.
Ball goes all the way back to the 24.
Well, shake your head and wonder, penalties really come from over-exuberance most of the time.
Well, Chris Flynn didn't fool Navy, but there again goes a penalty marker into the fray. We might have a face mask here. Didn't seem like there was anybody else around Flynn. Vince McBeth made the stop. Well, it's going to be against Penn once again. Vince McBeth, fine linebacker of Navy, a senior from Camden, Arkansas, number 19.
And that's two in a row. This time they're going to refuse the penalty, however.
Well, it makes it third down and about 13. Pennsylvania's trailing here, 10-3. Navy hoping to even this series. As I mentioned at the beginning of the show, 21 wins for Penn, 20 for Navy, 4 ties. Prochicchio to the sidelines. Oh, beautiful catch at the 45-yard line. Tom Joyce on the receiving end.
Great throw by Prochicchio. Joyce was only a step ahead of the receiver. We see Prochicchio drill the ball to the outside. Just one step Joyce has, but he also had body position. He had his body between the ball and the defender.
19 yards on the play, and that was Mark Kiefer right on his back.
Nothing makes you feel as good as overcoming a 10-yard penalty.
Here's Flynn, follows his blocker, leads his way, and fights his way across midfield to the 49-yard line. Mike Heron, number 10, eventually having to make the stop on it.
And when you overcome the penalty to make the first down, that truly builds confidence, and that's what this Penn team needs.
Let's take a short pause here for station identification. This is the Freedom Football Network. Well, you can see why Chris Flynn is leading the Ivy League in rushing, because he just picked up 7 yards. You'd swear he only got 3 or 4. Very deceptive. Good faking. But unfortunately, the pass by Krochicki is overthrown. Tom Joyce was the intended receiver. So it's third down and about 2.5 to 3 yards. And I would guess with either Camizio or with Flynn, the 3 yards would not be that difficult, Bud.
Well, Stefanon did a beautiful job of covering that pass. He ignored the play action, stayed right with the receiver, and now we get that big third down.
And the ball is given to Flynn. Well, he twists, and I think that last twist may have given him the first down.
That motion man that you see going across just before the snap, then changing direction, changes the support factors in the defensive secondary.
He made it by a foot. You do notice there, Novoselsky holding on to the hand of Chris Flynn.
That's unity.
Misdirection, and Flynn keeps on grinding to the 40. Got five.
Good ball carrier.
You bet.
A very good ball carrier. Perfect balance and great leg drive. Gets the handoff. Misdirection play. Look at his eyes as he sees everybody in the secondary and then has strength and power enough in the legs to fight through the tackles.
He leads the team in scoring with 30 points. And as Bud mentioned, an 8 yard per play average. Here's Krochikia. Good. I was going to say good protection, but he fired it over the head of the intended receiver, Ed Solari.
Good protection, but maybe he also had marvelous pass defense. Everybody covered.
So it's now 3rd down and 5. Tom Joyce reports into the lineup.
Penn is getting a good balance of pass run. They've hit the passes not as consistently as their running game has gone, but the balance will keep the Navy defense unsettled.
They're not quite within field goal range here. The ball is on the 40, so it's a 3rd and 5.
No remaining backs.
And this ball is batted down before it can get loose, and it's caught by Fuller before it hits the ground.
It's a remarkable play. Great reflexes, great reaction.
So let's see who bats it. Van Hulzen, I think you'll find, 85.
Back throwing, and bingo, there you are. And then Fuller has the presence to see the ball bouncing, get his hands underneath it, and make the interception before the ball can hit the ground.
How about that tackle by Krochikia? The quarterback came in and made a dandy. Back in just a moment. ...30-pound senior from Fridley, Minnesota. It was the man who got up there with that big ham hand of his and spanked the ball, and it came right down into the arms of Fuller. That's the reason Navy has the ball now on its own 44-yard line, leading here 10-3. There's Fuller, the one that came down with the ball. Good reaction.
Key defensive series for Penn. If they could stop the Navy this time, that again, we've kept talking about their confidence factor, but it's important.
And the handoff, only a couple of yards. Chuck Smith.
Penn was not sure how well they would move against a solid service academy football team as Navy is. It's a big, strong Navy team, and it's a veteran team. The further the game goes, and does not get one-sided, I would say the better Penn's chances become.
2nd down and 7. The ball on the 47-yard line of Navy. Once again, the good fake by Burnie, a little flip ahead.
And just an incomplete forward pass. An exciting play, but no fumble.
We'd like to welcome stations WTGS-TV in Savannah, Georgia, and WJTC-TV in the Mobile and Pensacola area to the Freedom Football Network today. Hope you're enjoying the game. With 7 minutes to go in this first half, Navy leading 10-3. The midshipman now with a big 3rd down and 7. From behind, a great defensive play by Brad Hippensteel. Number 99 came roaring in from his right outside linebacker spot, and he decks Byrne, making a 4th down. Boy, there's the best defensive play we've seen today.
And the blitz worked perfectly. No one blocked Hippensteel, as you can see him being the first man to get to him, but there are many other Penn rushers very close to Byrne.
Andy Muick went into the lineup very, very quickly from the Navy side, hoping to catch Pennsylvania in a change. And Pennsylvania wisely called timeout there because they didn't want to get caught. So the ball will be on the 40-yard line in Navy territory. And Muick will have to face a fairly stiff wind here when he punts on 4th down when we return. Pennsylvania is sending Chris Flynn back as a single safety. And Muick will be punting. I mentioned that because Flynn is a very dangerous runner.
Just give him a little daylight.
Yeah,
make
just give him,
happen.
Give him a couple of yards. Muick knows that. It's a very high kick. There'll be no return here. And he takes it to the 23-yard line. So Pennsylvania will go to work, and Bud, I think your point is well taken that, once again, Penn's defense has stopped Navy forcing a punt.
The only thing that's looked weak about the defense and the early drives of Navy, Byrne was able to find pass receivers open all of the time. The rushing defense has been excellent.
There's a good look at our crowd here today. A big weekend in Annapolis. The boat show is here in this game between Penn and Navy. Here's Lorano, the fullback, getting a couple of yards out to about the 27 or 28 yard line. 6 minutes, 23 seconds to go in this first half. 10-3 Navy. It's been a hard fought first half.
Penn keeps changing their formations. Anytime it's long yardage, they have gone with no running back in the backfield. They've put three wide receivers out to one side and a split end out to the other.
And now they have split backs with Chris Flynn in there. And he gets the ball as he goes outside. Good defensive play, however, by Curtis Irby, number 35.
One man just doesn't bring Flynn down. You can slow him down, but it's very hard to bring him down.
Third down coming up. Well, we've given credit to the Penn defense for stopping Navy. Let's give credit to this Navy defense for holding Penn to only 3 points. Penn's a pretty good scoring machine. Third and five. Ochikia down the center. Ooh, right off the fingertips of Bruni. And I think he felt that one because Kiefer was right there to belt him.
Pass was almost on target. Just a step too long. And that, of course, kept the completion from taking place. And a quick shift by the punting team by Penn.
Fourth down. Fosnock will be booting it about from the 20. High kick. Forcing Furley back to 23. Well, he did a pretty good job on his own up to the 32-yard line before the avalanche comes. 47-yard boot by Fosnock. And with 4:57 to go in the first half, we'll take this timeout. Gary Tranquil, the Navy coach here on the sidelines, 46 years old in his fifth year. He's a graduate of Wittenberg, where he was an outstanding quarterback, according to Rick Verzano. He was the most valuable player in 1960 in the Ohio Conference.
First and 10 at the 32 for Navy.
Chuck Smith missed, and he gets that extra 3 or 4 yards. Dexter Desir and Mike Lista on the stop.
The penetration was there, but he's a hard man to hit square enough to stop him when the first man is clear to get the shot.
Mike Lista made the tackle.
Looks like Brunn is going to the locker room on a leg or ankle or knee or whatever that doesn't look like it's very serviceable for the rest of the afternoon. Good faking by Byrne, but looks like Mike Ray might have been held up by Donald Wilson, number 21, because it was a flag over there in that area. Wilson's protesting it violently.
He's entitled to give him one shot.
Yep.
The referee said, you held him, you just didn't give him a shot.
Well, maybe we could see it on the replay. Guess not. Comes up to the 45-yard line. Well, penalties have hurt the Quakers. There's no doubt about that.
They had them in a long yardage situation had they not had the penalty called. But that, I think, is the seventh penalty that Penn has had thus far. Wrong. Five, according to the statistician.
Well, 60 yards is the big thing.
You bet.
On the 45, first and 10. Byrne on the end around. Troy Saunders coming, and he has two blockers. Well, I'll tell you one thing. Fangmeyer played it as well as you could play it defensively, number 29. He got loose of his man and forced the play inside. Gain of about, before he stepped out, I guess it got 9 yards. But as you saw, it was clipping on the play. That will nullify any 9-yard gain.
Very difficult when you have that outside field position closing when a man is coming around deep as you do on a deep reverse, not to take the shot when you know you really shouldn't. Here's the man that's going to get it. Fangmeyer. No, I guess not. Oh, he's behind on the left side of the screen. But there are so many people changing direction on a deep reverse that even the offensive blocker knows he shouldn't clip. The temptation remains awfully high. 3:55 to go in this second quarter. Navy hanging on to a 10-3 lead. Nice quick opener as Curtis Brown, the fullback, gets it all the way up to midfield. And once again, a marker goes into the fray as David Smith and James Fangmeyer, 38 and 29, bring him down. He's short of a first down, but there may be more coming. Beautiful trap play. Brown found the big hole, and he's got outstanding speed, averaging 5.6 yards per carry. And when he gets that kind of a start, that kind of quickness, he's a dangerous man. Bruce McConnell was the man who was guilty. You saw him there on the replay, number 45. The ball carrier, Brown, was clearly down, and he just came out of nowhere, it seemed, and pounced on him, and that really was costly. 15 yards down to the 35. Running to the end of the half, and that 15-yard penalty gives Navy marvelous field position as they swing it out to Smith. And Smith is forced out of bounds by Donald Wilson at about the 20, I'm going to call it the 28-yard line, marked at the 27. This is the sweep pass, Navy calls it. Smith just rolls it out. You throw the ball out there, and it gets there a little quicker than Smith can run with the ball, and it's a difficult play to have the defense able to cover the perimeter. Gain of 8 on the play, second down and 2. The ball on the 27-yard line. First down. Just inside the 25. Sebastianelli forcing him out of bounds, number 59 there. Give him short yardage, and Smith is very difficult to stop, keep from making the first down. Yeah, the thing I like about him is that he's got such speed to go outside. He's just, he's a very strong runner inside. I think he's more dangerous really out there. He's got as good acceleration, Bill, as any back that I've seen in a long time. He can really light that afterburner. First and 10, just inside the 25. Now he goes inside and finds that little hole, wedges it down to about the 17-yard line. Lister brings him down. I think you can see that blitz was on. Penn is expecting a pass. And when you're blitzing, you don't have any pursuit. If you don't make that first tackle, there isn't going to be the swarming of the defensive linebackers in secondary because they are rushing the passer. Second and 1, the ball is on the 16-yard line. 2 minutes and 49 seconds to go. Second quarter, Navy leading 7-3. Curtis Brown, the fullback, gets the first down.
That's a quick hitting trap.
In place of McKenna today, who was injured in the Air Force game. And so his backup will be the sophomore, Pat Donnelly. Brown's played well. He's blocked well, too. First down on the, we're going to call it the 11.5-yard line. Mike Ray out wide to the right. Vernon Wallace in motion. Change of direction, but the footing wasn't there for Chuck Smith and David Smith, number 38, sophomore out of Shelton, Connecticut, brings him down.
Very good defensive call. Had everybody coming. The ball was not put in the air. Smith had no room to run.
One thing, the ball is directly in front of the uprights, but it's only second down. So a couple of more shots here, and Navy may very well elect to go for the field goal. They did the last time and made it 10-3. Byrne, a little bit of pressure, lobs it too far into the end zone, and Sniffen.
That little bit of pressure was the key on the play. Byrne just did not have time to let the receiver clear. Had to put the ball in the air before he was open.
Third down. And considering where the ball is on the field, I would rather imagine they'll either run it up the middle or try another pass play to keep it in position for the field goal kicker. Third and 12. Bill Byrne, senior quarterback of Pacifica, California.
over the middle. He's got Mike Ray at the five, but it's not enough. It's fourth down and three. And the question is, do you go for the first down on fourth down, or do you go for what could be an easy three?
Well, the blitz was on again, but Ray was the hot receiver. When the blitz is coming, a short man is always open, as Ray was that time. He picked up the completed pass on the play, but not enough yardage for the first down, and the field goal unit is on.
Ted Fundukas, who has a 37-yarder to his credit. We'll try this one from 22. It's good. And with 1 minute and 6 seconds to go in this first half, Navy has now gone up 13-3. Two field goals by Ted Fundukas.
It's not a great lead. I think that Navy was confident they'd have a bigger lead at this point in time. And Penn, if they can get over the penalties, penalties, has just destroyed their offensive attack. They've also had some costly penalties on defense. But if they can get over the penalty situation in the second half, they can still be a factor in the game.
Now, you made a point, though, however, Bud, earlier. You said that Penn was coming in. You'd seen the team and everything, and they looked mean and aggressive and everything. Maybe this is just simply a manifestation of that. They won it so badly.
I think that's true. Penalties are really just from over-exuberance. No one deliberately is breaking any rules ever. But you're trying so hard, and in a game of combat, you can exceed what is allowed.
Coming up at halftime, we'll present our weekly feature on the Academy Experience. And this week, a rather interesting subject, Yard Patrol at Annapolis.
Well, it's in my neighborhood, Phil, sometimes.
Sign them up. It started out to be a rather sunny day, but now with this overcast, it's gotten rather cloudy. Ball was kicked out of bounds. That'll be a 5-yard violation. And Navy will kick again from the 30. Well, the Blues are out now. As you know, we were here 2 weeks ago in very warm weather, and the Navy Whites were on, but then the seasons changed, and so did the uniforms.
Very impressive, whether they're in blue or in white.
Particularly the marching. You hear the drum and bugle corps, and then you look over toward the campus, and here they come. Sunderland will do the booting here. The question is, will he try the onside kick, or will he just kick it away? May not be all the strategy in the world, because I think what he really would like to do is keep it out of the wind, try to keep it low.
A much more drastic penalty than it used to be. When the ball is kicked from the 35-yard line and then you get the 5-yard penalty for kicking out of bounds, you're kicking from the 30, and that almost guarantees excellent field position for the receiving team.
Flynn and Bruni are back. They're checking with the sideline official, who is the official timekeeper. Apparently there's something wrong with the scoreboard clock. It says 104, and we have no idea whether that's too much or too little. The score is right, 13-3 on the scoreboard. Navy out in front by 10 over a stubborn Pennsylvania team here in this first half. You know, a very low kick, and it's picked up by one of the short men and pitches it back to Chris Flynn. Well, if you're going to pitch it to somebody, he's the guy to pitch it to.
I think the strategy was excellent, but the execution just didn't follow through. See, one of the short men will catch the kick here in the bounce. He tosses it back to Flynn, and Flynn took his eyes off the ball. The execution was pretty good. It was a fumble by Flynn that failed to complete the pass.
Let's not hold Alexic guilty. Now, this time, trying to go outside was not the wisest move by Flynn. Number 76 there is Troy Holland, and John Fuller in on the tackle. The scoring drive was climaxed by that 22-yard field goal by Fundukas. Here we go.
Penn feels, though, very good that we didn't let him score a touchdown. We forced him to kick a field goal again.
Twice in a row that's happened. Flynn staggers to the 26-yard line. Clock moving, 25 seconds to go in the first half.
Troy Holland once again in on the stop.
Navy's been very impressive defensively. Been difficult for the Penn offense to get on track with any consistency.
And the clock has stopped now with 13 seconds to go as Jim Krochikia, the senior quarterback from Pennsylvania, will go over to talk to Ed Zubrow. Gives us a chance to look at one of the youngest coaches in America today in major college football. Zubrow's only 35 years old.
This is his first year as head coach, and he has his team going into this game undefeated. Navy, of course, taking the timeout, hoping that they can force Penn to kick and get the ball again before the half runs out.
Jim Krochikia went to Holy Cross High School in Southbury, Connecticut. Doesn't run much, but he has a 52% completion record. He's only had one interception, you know. That's not bad.
He's also very good on the rollout passes and the bootleg. He hasn't done that very much thus far, but in the second half, I look for him to start using the sprint out pass and the bootleg.
Third down. 13 seconds to go. Maybe the final play of the first half. Again, the short pump, and he goes deep, but three Navy men are there, and one of them comes down with the football. It was intended for Brent Novoselski, and it's Mark Furley, I believe, who will get credit for the interception. There he is, number 41. That ends the first. Well, wait a second now. It doesn't end it. There's a marker down, and Troy Holland has gotten into it with one of the Penn players, number 77, Scott Ernst.
I certainly remember my version of the story.
That's all that matters.
But it was the end of the first half. Again, this was smash mouth football. It was an interception thrown, and I was running after the ball carrier. He stepped out of bounds, and out of the corner of my eye, I saw this guy bearing down on me. So I wheeled around and surprised him a little bit because I got right into him pretty good. And the ref, again, my version of the story, thought that was inappropriate. So I got to liven up the locker room a little bit at halftime and then, you know, become a cheerleader for the second half.
Well, Holland will tip the scales at 235 and Ernst about 260.
Both heavyweights. Good match.
And it's going to be against Pennsylvania.
And he's out of there. Another penalty.
Well, but did you see the thumb?
Yep.
That means Scott Ernst will not be with us for the rest of the afternoon, a senior from Tiverton, Rhode Island, at the offensive left tackle spot. So Jeff Sheftick, number 66, will be in there in his place. So we still have 6 seconds to go in this first half. Ed Zubrow and that blue shirt over there on the sidelines, pacing up and down. He doesn't like that at all.
The team needs to, between halves, get some poise, talk about what penalties have cost them in the first half, and then resolve that we aren't going to commit any infractions in the second half. 90 yards already.
So Bernie's going to go to the air here on what looks like could be the last play of the half. He's out of bounds at the 24-yard line, Mike Ray, but the clock has run out in this first half after a fine reception by this young man who scored the only touchdown for Navy against Air Force last week. So the players get a good round of applause from the fans here at the Navy Marine Corps Memorial Stadium. It's been a hard fought and a rather tenacious first half. And Navy leading 13-3 as the smoke clears there. Can we find our colleague Rick Forzano on the field?
Thank you. Gary Tranquil, the head coach of Navy. Gary, the only ones that think that there's easy football games are the alumni. Your thoughts on the first half?
Well, I don't think we played particularly well. Offensively, again, we've had our problems, Rick. Defensively, we've played decently. But you're right, there aren't any easy football games. You've got to be ready to play every week.
Good luck in the second half, Gary.
All right, Rick. So Navy leads it by the score of 13-3. The midshipmen have proven one thing, that they are not thinking too much about what happened last week. They're thinking about Pennsylvania, and well, they should.
Scott Ernst, Rich Camizio, James Fangmeyer, Bruce McConnell, and Jeff Fortna. Guys, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having us.
Good to be here.
If you can remember the week leading up to this game, what was the feeling in practice? You guys are, at this time, it's 1AA and 1A. You're stepping up to play 1A Navy. You guys were obviously very good, but anytime you step up like this, it's a challenge. What was the feel in practice and such?
Everybody outside of Franklin Field definitely thought we were going to lose the game.
We knew we had our work cut out for us, but we were fired up and we were confident.
And, you know, we were getting to a point in our season where we thought we were recognizing we're a really good team and that we're a tough team.
We felt really good. We were healthy. Our defense looked great. Our offense was kicking in. We were running. We were passing.
We went down there to win. We went down there to play and win. We didn't go down there to show up.
Do you remember going into that game feeling good about the matchups and thinking that there were some things in the passing game that if we got what we thought we were going to get, we can make plays?
Oh, we were licking our chops because we watched film and we noticed their safeties were very aggressive. Literally, they were coming out hard at us and we'd give a little out move and they'd try to come up and then I had a quick, easy lane down the field. Thank goodness Krichicki had a good arm.
They had a pretty good running back. I think his name was Chuck Smith. What was the focus for you guys defensively when you were breaking down that Navy offense?
If they were going to run the ball all day, we felt like we were really in great shape to control them because we had some pretty tough guys up front. And throughout the entire game, we were, we punched in the mouth.
Halftime, it's 13-3. Rich, offensively, only 3 points, but you guys moved the ball. By no means were you guys stifled. How are you guys feeling as those first two quarters are moving along there? Because it seems like you're doing some of the things you want to do.
It wasn't our greatest running game, but the great thing about our team and, offense in particular was, we had Krichicki at quarterback. Novo at tight end, we had great split ends. So we had several weapons. So, they were intent on shutting the running game down and being very aggressive with their safeties and defensive backs coming up. We identified that early in the week. We prepared for it.
The yardage might not have been what you were used to, but could you feel like you were starting to wear them down a little bit defensively with how you guys were coming at them?
Early on, they were up on the line and they were going to stop us at the run as much as they could. In the second half, with the success that we had in the air, it kind of pushed them back a little bit. And that was just enough. Instead of the 1 or 2 yard gains or ones for loss, they were 4, 4.5, 5 yards, 6 yards. And man, when you start getting that on maybe the first down or the second down, it's like, man, you're going to go eat. Because you know that you're getting another first down. As a team, we did a good job of capitalizing in the second half and getting those 4, 5, 6 yard plays.
With 15 minutes to go, you guys are down 10.
We never thought about losing. It just never occurred in any of our games. It really wasn't our mindset. And, we felt like we were really, giving it to them. And the offense was too.
We always knew we were in it. We were playing hard, but all of a sudden it's like, the score's getting tight. We got them worried. That was key.
I thought it was just going to be a game of attrition. We got to just keep beating them down, because we were just coming at them hard, the entire time. And I thought the fourth quarter was just going to be our time to just really take it to them and just wear them out completely.
I think they were really surprised at how aggressive we were with them.
I thought Jimmy had a clear vision all day of, the field, of the defense. And, the bottom line is when the plays needed to be made, he found Brett, he found Jim Bruni, and he was able to capitalize.
We earned every bit of that win. They didn't give us anything.
The Navy game was as big as it gets. Right. There's no doubt. Like going down and playing in that venue, in that situation and coming out the way it did is, I don't want to underplay. It's life changing.
Every single guy on that 86 team had a big piece in this game and in that season. And we had faith in all of them.
Everybody made a play, 11 guys on the field at one time. Someone's going to step up and do it. We trusted each guy to be able to make that play. Every time we got in the defense, we got pushed up against the wall. You know, we looked at each other and said, all right, whose turn is it? And someone would make a play.
You know, that's what great teams do. Somebody, you know, steps up to the plate and, you know, fills in shoes, and the following week it's somebody else.
This was a lot of fun. I hope it was as much fun for you going down memory lane. And I'd like to thank all of you for being a part of our virtual season opener here for the University of Pennsylvania.
Jim Crocchia will, Crocchia will be at the quarterback spot. Comizio, Lorano, and Saunders. But with the report on Comizio, it looks like Chris Flynn, who is there at the top of your picture to receive the ball, may very well stay in the lineup. He's there with Bruni, number 42. And here is Sunderland. And the second half is underway. Flynn at the 13. Snagged at about the 31-yard line. Number 44, Dan Snyder, in on the stop on the specialty team. So let's set this lineup for you. The Quakers going offensively. Andrews will be one wide receiver. Brent Novoselski will be the tight end. Ernst has been ejected from the game, so that means that Sheftick will start at tackle. Then Wilkins, Venato, Panzini, and Peterson up front. Krochickia, the quarterback. As Novoselski swings over to the left side. And Flynn, as mentioned, starting in place of Comizio, gets a couple of yards. Defensively for Navy, we have Murray Cook, Bob Plants, Enoch Blazes, Troy Holland, and Chad Van Hulzen up front. Macbeth and Doman, the two fine linebackers. Then Stefanon, Kiefer, Furley, and Heron.
Navy defensive team, Bill, has 10 seniors in the starting lineup, so that's great experience.
Second and two, ball on the 32-yard line. Krochickia, ball is bobbled by Bruni.
Have not been able to hit consistently with their passing attack. Their running attack looks to be good, as we see an injured player down.
Bruning, the fellow who just caught the ball.
Trying to catch it, got bombed at the moment, but he was trying to make the reception. We take a look at the pass again, and you can see the leg being hit and turned under. You gotta feel that hurts. Hope it's not a serious injury. And so he's shaking it off very well.
Third down, third and nine. It's the third time today that a pass has been batted by a Navy interior lineman. Kent Van Horn has been the one assigned to do that, and I guess he's got the size of hands that can do it.
And it's a 6'3", 205-pound quarterback, Krochickia, so he's not short.
Pennsylvania going quickly with Fasnacht, the punter, going in without a huddle. Furley's back for Navy. Another desultory rush. I did not see the fair catch called for, but
I don't think that he did signal fair catch.
You know, he's fair game if he didn't. But the flag went in.
May have been they didn't give him room enough. You have to give the man receiving the punt one full yard.
That's what it was. Interference with the opportunity to catch it, and even though he caught it, there's still going to be another penalty chalked off against the so-called peaceful Quakers.
They're not playing that way. They had seven penalties for 90 yards in the first half, and they opened the second half with a penalty.
couple scores coming in. I know you're interested in the Army-Holy Cross game. Holy Cross ahead of Army in the second quarter. Pitch goes to Chuck Smith. Drives the short side of the field, and that's one of his few fumbles. He fumbled the ball, and Bruce McConnell, number 45, came up with it to give Pennsylvania the ball. Now talk about a change in momentum.
Smith gets the ball cleanly, but he is really hit. Number 94 drove his fist through the ball, caused the fumble, and it's a great turnover for Penn.
You know, Chuck Smith prides himself in not fumbling. He has very, very strong hands and arms, but, you know, if you get the ball just right, you can knock that spheroid out of there. First down. Good faking by Krochicki, and he goes long.
A little too long.
Scungio, number 81, senior from Abington, Maryland, was the intended receiver. More scores. Air Force getting its lumps today. 31-3 from Notre Dame in the fourth quarter. Pretty tight game in the third with Rutgers. Army's opponent next week, Boston College, bombing Louisville in the fourth. Ivy League, Cornell over Brown. Spengio switches over to the opposite side. Second down, 10. Penn trailing by the score of 13-3. Flynn playing in place of Rich Camizio, and I think we may have a report on Camizio's condition. Rick Borzano?
Bill, I watched Rich Camizio run on the sideline. He has a pulled hamstring. He wants to get in the ball game, but he was running like it was awfully tender. I just don't know if we'll see him back in this football game today.
Well, we hate to have you on the injury brigade here, but we have Chad Van Hulzen is down for Navy. Fine defensive end who has really played well today, and Red Romo is out there looking at him.
Tom, I'm going to go check him out.
Okay, go ahead.
Krochicki's really had his problems throwing the ball today. He's only 4 of 15 passes for 56 yards, and he's thrown two interceptions. So the Navy secondary is having a fine defensive football game. Krochicki having trouble completing his passes to balance up the offense.
I would think that would be rather critical to Penn. If you're going to get Flynn outside or Camizio inside, you've really got to open things up. It's been very obvious that once either Flynn or Camizio's had the ball, there have been three or four Navy men right on him. Third down. Straight handoff to Lorano, the fullback from Revere, Massachusetts. Doesn't carry a lot, but on this particular one, he got 9 quick yards.
And everybody from the Navy team was thinking pass. And as you mentioned a moment ago, when you get everybody thinking the wrong thing, offense has got an opportunity.
Well, I don't know. Decision time. Fourth down and about a foot. But Penn decides to go without a huddle and sends the kicking team in. Posnock. His long is 47 yards this year. This one he floats high, and Furley inside the 10 will take the ball at the 8-yard line, and that's where Navy will take over. 12 minutes, 33 seconds to go in this third quarter. 35-yard boot. Navy still leads it by 10. On the sideline is number 85, Navy's fine defensive right end, Chad Van Hulzen, a senior from Fridley, Minnesota, and they're attending to that left knee or leg. I don't know that the way he came out doesn't look like he'll get back in, but we'll get a report from Rick. First down and 10 on the 8-yard line. Navy trying to protect here. A 10-point lead as Chuck Smith gets it out to about the 10. Brad Heinz, the co-captain Rover, brings him down, number 46.
Navy stays tough with the running defense. The Army-Navy passing has been the key factor in the lead that they presently hold.
Not up to the 10.
New defensive lineman by Penn.
And Byrne in his end zone being chased. Just throws it away. Gianelli, number 59, ball hawking him in there.
He did have a, we can see Van Hulzen walking here, but Byrne was able to throw in the vicinity of a receiver, so it was not intentional grounding.
Let's take a short pause here for station identification. This is the Freedom Football Network. Third down, about 8.
They stopped them here. The decision to punt will prove to have been wise.
Byrne. Oh, this one is stabbed by Fangmeyer. Fangmeyer still on his feet at the 15-yard line. His progress was stopped. That is the second one that they picked off today, and McGoldrick had to bring him down. Fangmeyer, a senior from Rockville, Maryland, 16-yard return.
Byrne is not pressured too much, but he throws a little bit too quickly. The receiver was breaking behind Pang Byrne, but he came up, read the throw very well, was closing on the ball to make the interception, and when you underthrow it, those things always happen.
Van Hulzen has gone back in the game. Number 85 at defensive right end for Navy. Hand off to Flynn. Flynn is snagged by Van Horn, number 73. I'll tell you, now, when you watch this interception again, just watch the great dive that the Navy receiver makes. He really makes a great effort here.
There's no pressure, but the ball is thrown too quickly. Great recovery, and the defensive secondary all reacted beautifully to it. It's an interception, and we change from a defensive team to an offensive team.
And Bruni gallops to about the 9. Now, this could make a heck of a difference in everything in this third quarter with plenty of time to go. Should Pennsylvania score to make it 13-10, it would get a bit more tense for Navy.
And again, that conference factor that we've been talking about all afternoon would be building from Penn.
Third down. 3rd and 3. Split back with Rolano. Cross buck, and Flynn wiggles through, but he's short of the first down. Gets to about the 8. I'd say he's about a yard and a half short.
A good misdirection play, however. Maybe he was unsettled just enough to open up a slight bit of daylight, and now it's decision time.
I think they're just going to say, come on, let's try to get it in there for the first down.
When you're behind 13-3, it's the proper decision.
So Troy Holland, number 76, reports into the lineup.
Ed Zubrow going to look at this one very closely.
Ed Zubrow, the 35-year-old coach of Pennsylvania. Look at this. Kochicki had a pass. He has a man open in the end zone. Touchdown! Novoselsky in the end zone. But there is a marker down at the line of scrimmage, so let's see what it is. Could be nullified.
Beautiful, courageous call. When you're going that 4th and 1, you're always slightly fearful of putting the ball in the air, but they made the beautiful play action, and it worked, and we're getting the decision now of the officials, and I believe the touchdown is going to stand.
Henson Price. Touchdown is counted. So the personal foul will take effect on the kickoff, and Pennsylvania will be kicking from midfield, which was another break. About time they got a break on penalties, isn't it?
That was a big one. And again, marvelous execution of that play-action pass. Receiver wide open in the end zone. Navy looking for them to try to make the 4th and less than a yard.
Here's Jim Grass's drive for point. It's good. And it's a 13-10 ball game. So that score triggered by a fine interception by Fangmeyer, leading to 7 points.
How big was that score for you guys defensively? Just kind of giving you guys a jolt?
Yeah, I mean, it was huge. Anytime you have a turnover, you know, that actually is my interception, my first interception of that season. And to have them score just psyched me up unbelievably. And I think it just charged up our entire defense.
Can you believe it? Fourth and one, and they did this play.
Well, it's beautiful play action faking. They faked the fullback one way, the tailback the other way, so you had total misdirection. Navy totally supporting the run, trying to keep the first down from being made, left themselves vulnerable to the touchdown pass. Great play action. And the penalty for roughness after the play has the kickoff team kicking it from the 50-yard line, which means they ought to be able to put it into the end zone, and awfully close there too.
That was Novoselsky's third touchdown of the year. Wallace is back along with Chuck Smith.
Grass hopes to kick it very, very high. Instead of that, he booms it right downfield.
Vernon Wallace gets it out to the 27-yard line. And it looked like the Pennsylvania team defensively is saying, boy, I'll tell you one thing, that 7 points did a lot for us.
Very good return when you're kicking from the 50-yard line and they get it out to the 27. That's excellent performance by the special team.
First down.
And Navy thinking, we got to make something happen here. We can't turn the ball over again to this inspired Penn team.
Short one. And Brown, the fullback, gets it out to about the 38-yard line. 11 yards.
This gives you some idea of Brown's great athletic running ability. Vern pops the ball to him, and watch him slip this first tackler. Almost kept his balance. It's again on the replay.
And Chuck Smith gets it forward up to about the 42.
And the scoring drive after the interception, when you're that close to the goal line, it really helps you. Four plays, 16 yards, but the key play, the play action pass with less than a yard to go on fourth down.
What that does not show is Fangmeyer's interception.
That was the big play that set it up.
Second down, 5. 8:40 to go, third quarter. Chuck Smith. You know, Chuck's been running to the short side of the field an awful lot today. And you wonder what would happen if he ran to the wide side, because he does have good sprinter speed.
That last play was, again, one of the marvelous examples of the talent of this ball carrier, Chuck Smith.
Enough for the first down, right at midfield. Rick, do you have something?
The only thing that worries me about Chuck Smith is when he goes to his right, he carries the ball in his left hand, and you can fumble the ball doing that.
Well, he did before, you remember?
Yes, sir.
Look at those legs. Well, he only got two out of it. His forward progress stopped by Fortner.
I really feel that maybe is getting ready to put the ball in the air again, because the Penn defense is closing very quickly on the running plays.
That's about as slow as Chuck Smith has ever gotten up from the tackle. And I watched him when he walked back, Bud, and he had just a slight limp. He'd never let anybody know unless the leg was broken. Second down and 9. Pass to Smith. And he's belted at about the 37-yard line. First down for Navy.
You get the ball to Smith in an open field where he's in a one-on-one situation, and it's almost a mismatch. Vern drops back. Finds Smith running a little curl pattern. Smith is wide open, and now it's one-on-one in the open field, and he can always pick up extra yardage.
Taking lessons from Billy, number 22. Oh, he's butt heads today with a lot of defenders. Bill. Once again, Smith carries Listov, brings him down inside the 35. It's a 13-10 game. Navy holding on to a three-point lead here in the third quarter. We have 6:55 to go in it.
And you can watch the changing patterns of the Penn defense as the Navy team breaks the huddles and comes up to the ball. They're sometimes in a 3-2 set, but often they have six men on the line of scrimmage taking on each of the Navy offensive linemen individually. And here they're in that pattern again.
Hollinger in motion. Out of protection, and he goes to Hollinger, and it is tipped. Oh, that one was almost picked off by Donald Wilson. In the fourth quarter, Holy Cross and Army are tied at 14 now. Notre Dame defeated Air Force 31-3. Florida over Rutgers 15-3. And a final, Boston College 41, Louisville 7.
Boston College is getting better as the season goes along.
And we'll be testing Army. That'll be November the 1st. You'll see that game at Mikey Stadium. Third down. Here's Chuck Smith with some running room, but it closes up on him. David Smith, number 38, and Bruce McConnell, number 45, making the stop on him. We'd like to welcome stations WXLI-TV in Minneapolis and WCIV-TV in Charleston, South Carolina, to our Freedom Football Network today. Fourth down for Navy.
And they're out of field goal range, so that was a very fine stand after they'd made three successive first downs by the Penn defense.
Look at this.
Maybe they're going to go for something else. We're getting that field goal attempt, and that's going to be a long one.
Well, Sunderland made one 40 yards against Air Force.
40-yard effort.
Let's go! 50 yards, but there's a marker down.
Boy, what a tough penalty. We talked about the penalties for Penn. When you get a penalty after a 50-yard field goal, that takes 3 points off the board and moves the kicker back five more yards. You wonder if he'll try it again.
I think I misspoke. I said against Air Force. It was against Dartmouth that he got that long one. Well, they're not going to even try this time. Buick has gone into punt. Very tranquil there on the sidelines.
That makes you shake your head when you're coaching.
Well, you're wondering, you know, what the procedure was. Probably a lineman just lifting. Newick angles it over toward the sideline. It is hit, picked up, and it is going to be down on the 7-yard line. Chris Flynn has the ball for Penn, but that puts the Quakers in a rather deep spot here with 5:24 to go in the third. Rick Verzano was right down in the end zone. Rick, we're watching the replay of this. How did you see it?
Well, I see it as an illegal touch by the Navy man. He was the end zone when he touched the ball on about the 1-yard line, which means the ball should go about to the 20-yard line as a touchback.
You could definitely see that his foot was, he had gone into the end zone, and when he touched it, he legally was in the end zone. Well, whatever it was a pretty smart play by Flynn to pick it up.
The way the decision worked out. If Flynn fumbles the ball after it's been touched, it can go back to that spot.
Flynn gets it up to about the 12-yard line. I mentioned earlier that Smith was limping a little bit when he went back, and he was favoring the left leg or left ankle. And I still think he is. You might ask him, Rick.
8-4.
Okay.
He's a hard man to keep out of the game.
Oh, as I said, unless it's broken.
You bet.
And then he might play for a quarter. I remember doing a soccer match once with a player with a broken leg, and he played almost 20 minutes. Sounds hard to believe, but it does happen with some athletes. 4:47 to go in the third. Nice hole opens up in the middle for Tom Clark, the fullback, playing in place of Lorano. He gets it pretty close to a first down.
And that was the same backfield faking as the play-action pass that scored the touchdown for Penn a few moments ago.
Third down and about a yard and a half. Let's call it two. It's a 10 for Penn, a 13 for Navy game. 4:06 to go in the third. Wachikia gives it off to Flynn. I'll tell you, there was sheer effort. He was only about 6 inches off the ground as he got those last 2 yards. First down.
He's a very determined runner. And he also has that ability to stop and start without losing any forward speed.
4 minutes to go, third. And a first and 10. Well, this is where Pennsylvania should have started. But on that punt that was illegally touched, it was not caught by the officials, so Pennsylvania's had to make these 13 yards the hard way. Wachikia's pass out of bounds.
Again, beautiful pass defense, great coverage.
Solari was the intended receiver. I gave you that final a moment ago, 31-3, Notre Dame over Air Force. Florida final, beating Rutgers 15-3. Rutgers will be Army's opponent next week. Boston College over Louisville 41-7. Flynn once again gets it up to about the 24-yard line. Cloud cover starting to move out a little bit as we get some sunshine. It's been a very pleasant day, though. I guess you judge everything by comparison and compare it to a week ago.
Very simple. Flynn is really a clever runner. Great balance and that ability to stop, change direction, and then accelerate.
Third down and 7. On count by Krochikia.
Checking signals.
Well, he checked them right into Van Horn.
Navy expecting pass was blitzing, and when everybody's blitzing, there very seldom is any lane open.
Georgia Tech and Auburn playing today. Auburn at the half, leading Georgia Tech 17-3. Georgia over Vanderbilt in a final. And Iowa leading Michigan 10-3 in the first quarter at Ann Arbor. Bosnock. It's a high spiral floating down to Furley at the 37.
Big kick coverage.
There's Ed Zubrow on the sidelines, this young coach of Pennsylvania, 73 graduate of Haverford College. He's a native Philadelphian who came to Penn as an assistant under Jerry Burnt in 1981, serving as the defensive line coach. Also, he was the recruiting coordinator up until last January when Burnt went on to Rice as the head coach. And he is given much of the credit for Penn's 4 straight Ivy League championships since the strong defense did it. Here's Chuck Smith. Getting down to the 45-yard line, and so with a 15-yard gain on that one, it doesn't look like he was too hurt, although you do see him limping a little.
This is that pass sweep again. Smith just takes off from the outside, and the ball is thrown to him, which gets the ball wider quicker than you would on an ordinary handoff to the tailback.
On the 46, 1:53 to go in the third quarter. Navy leading by 3. Nice quick opener to Curtis Brown. Look at him dance around, and he's pulled down from behind. Seeping in there is Brad Hippensteel. He was able to get him collared at the 25 after a 21-yard gain.
We talk so much about Chuck Smith and what a great ball carrier he is, but Brown is in the same class. He's averaging 5.6 yards, and he's got that explosive start that gets him past the line of scrimmage when he gets a little opening and is there so quickly that he is past the linebackers before they have a chance to read and recover.
First down on the 25. There's Chuck Smith. Boy, he just barrels it to the 13-yard line, punishing Fangmeyer on the tackle.
And the Navy line beginning to take control. These last holes have been opened beautifully, and Smith and Brown have just taken the openings, and when you give those two backs openings, they're going to pick up big yardage.
13 on that one. First down on the 12.
Move, move.
Smith again. He breaks loose and goes in to score. That proves the old theory. You better grab him by the ankles or you'll never bring him down.
Smith, great body position when he's carrying the ball. He's low, his shoulders. As we take a look at Smith popping in, keeping his body square, having enough leg drive balance to just run through the safety man coming up to make the tackle and to go into the end zone standing up.
So Fundukas will try the extra point. It's 19-10 now in favor of Navy. And that makes it 20. 56 seconds to go in the third quarter, and once again, the cannon is fired. Well, any thought we had that Chuck Smith might be favoring that ankle or leg was quickly dispelled. And even though he might limp a little bit when he's walking, he certainly doesn't show any effects as he goes over there to talk to Gary Tranquil, his coach. I'm particularly pleased to see Chuck come back this week, Bud. I know you are. Such a fine runner and a great player that his frustration of last week obviously hurt him quite a bit. He had a very quiet week at practice, but he is certainly showing it today. I mean, as far as enthusiasm for the game.
He's had 28 carries thus far, Bill, for 115 yards, so it's another in excess of 100 yards a day for him.
I want to mention to you that next week it'll be a noon Eastern time start for those stations carrying us live on the Freedom Football Network. Should be a good matchup, the Black Knights and the Red Knights. 56 seconds to go in this third quarter, and Chuck Smith, who has just scored the touchdown, get a good look at him on the sidelines. Wants to become an astronaut or cosmonaut. Oh, look at Flynn go up almost to the 40-yard line.
Those are good plays when the front men, who are not very fancy ball carriers, handle the kickoff and then have the composure to throw the ball back to a ball carrier who is truly dangerous. This was Navy's best drive of the day. Four plays, 61 yards, and it just took them a minute and 17 seconds. It was totally dominated by the Navy offensive line.
Wasn't their longest, but certainly their most efficient. Their one in the first quarter went 86 yards. So it's a 20-10 game. We have 45 seconds to go in the third quarter. Pennsylvania Quakers really fighting their hearts out here today against the midshipmen, but penalties have hurt. Something awful. Ball is slipped to Chris Flynn. Weaves his way through those holes and gets almost to the point to gain for a first down. In fact, they may mark it, but it was enough. It's to me like it is.
Every good ball carrier reads the blockers, has enough balance to change direction and then accelerate, as you can see Flynn doing, picking up almost a first down. And they're bringing the chains in to see if he did.
Rick Frazzano, do you have something for us?
When I watch number 27, Chris Flynn, run the football, reminds me of another 27. Joe Bellino, Heisman Trophy winner for Navy, had the same leg drive, the same balance, and the ability to find the open hole.
What's he doing now, Rick?
Joe is, I believe, still living in Massachusetts and has his own catering company. I believe that's true.
After serving in the Armed Forces?
He sure did. He served 4 years and then played some of the Patriots, and Joe was a great back and a great human being.
Those
he is
words,
a great human being.
From the former Navy coach, Rick Frazzano. That'll be a first down by Jim. Well, he was on the first down. I guess it's just over the midfield stripe for a second down and nine. He got about 1.5. Rooney's run hard today, too. He's giving Flynn a breather. We have not seen Camizio, so I don't know. In the second half, I'm wondering if that hamstring is simply going to keep him out of the ball game for the rest of the afternoon. Well, that's the end of three quarters now here at the Navy Marine Corps Memorial Stadium. Navy on top by 10. Second and nine. Up. Well, Chick, you can't find anybody. And the marker goes down.
Krochicki is passed.
Novoselsky was out running parallel with the quarterback, but he was hounded so badly that Krochicki wisely decided not to throw to him.
He made a very good decision.
Might have been an inadvertent throw. I don't know. We got a wave off from the Vincent Price, our referee.
We see it again, and you can see the Krochicki rolling out. Gets the ball away. But I think that was offensive pass interference, it looked like to me, but I'm not positive.
Third down. Now there's a marker down. Incompleted pass to Rob Andrews.
That was an audible. Obviously, he changed his play at the line of scrimmage, but maybe he was ready for it as we look at the officials and get the call.
Illegal shift?
That's what he called it.
Well, let's take a look at a couple of other scores while they contemplate what to do here. We gave you that one a moment ago. Oklahoma, having a struggle against Oklahoma State, 6-0 at the half. And no score in that annual shootout between Texas and Arkansas. Brigham Young over Wyoming in the first quarter. That surprises me a little bit.
That surprises me more than a little bit.
Well, it's fourth down, and Posnock comes in the lineup to do the punting for Pennsylvania. Mark Furley is back for the midshipmen. 14:46 to go in this ball game, and Navy leading it by 10. It'll be hard to return this one. Real high. So Navy will take over on the 17-yard line.
Yeah. Posnock has done a good job of putting the ball up in the air.
32-yard boot. But what's more important, there was no return. Magnificent crab. A couple yards by Chuck Smith.
Smith has had a good day as we look at total yardage, and Navy has doubled almost the Pennsylvania output.
Navy player getting up a little on the slow side, Tim Brunn, who was injured in the first quarter and came out of the lineup. Now is going to jog off again. Troy Saunders goes in the lineup. Don Hughes comes out. Second down and 8. Ball is on the 20. Navy leading by 10. We're in the fourth quarter, 14:40 to go. Don Hull, the replacement for Chuck Smith, getting a couple of more yards. In case you joined us a little bit late, here's how the scoring went today. Hollinger getting the first touchdown of the afternoon. Navy went up 7-0, and then Grass's field goal made it 7-3. Fundukas added a pair for Navy to make it 13-3. And then in the third quarter, Novoselsky caught a little floater in the end zone by Krochicki. And then Navy came back with really a fine drive of 61 yards, climaxed by the Chuck Smith touchdown. That's the score we have right now, 20-10. 13.5 to go. Hollinger in motion. Almost picked off. That was pretty dangerous. John Sniffen and Mike Henley battling for it. Henley getting his hands on it, but couldn't hold it.
He was in perfect position. He had reacted to the ball as it was put in the air, and it was a little bit low, and he couldn't quite get both hands on the ball fast enough to make the catch.
Andy Muick, with no rush on him, so to speak, gets it away, and it comes over midfield, taken by Flynn, and that's where the Quakers will have the football. 30-yard boot by Navy. And the Quakers are not that far from the Navy end zone, 50 yards. And the midshipmen have reacted to it. They're leading by the score of 20-10. We have 13:18 to go in the ballgame.
We've been talking about how if Penn could stay in the game for the fourth quarter, and they've done that, maybe they'll threaten.
First and 10 on the 50. Krochikia, with a lot of time, fires it. Misdirected, however, his man cut in. Saunders cut in on it instead of cutting out.
Did a good job of picking up the blitz, though. The offensive line was able to protect the passer.
So it makes it second and 10.
Krochicki going into this game had hit 52% of his passes, but he's only 5 of 2, so his percentage has gone down considerably this afternoon.
Faking, pass to Flynn, gets a good block, and Flynn gets it for a first down at the 35-yard line.
Macbeth has to bring him down. Can't execute a screen pass any better than that. When you throw a screen, you want to convince the defense that you're going to throw a pass downfield. And you can see Krochikia looking downfield and then dumping the ball off in the fat to Flynn, who had some fine blocking and also does some very good ball clearing as usual for the first down.
I think that was Steve Bonato, the center, who got out there and knocked that man down for him, enabling him to go that extra 5 or 10 yards. First down on the 36. Middle pretty well jammed up. Joe Lorano, the fullback, just couldn't find any room at all.
I think the call was good after you hit a screen pass for the yardage that Penn did. You normally think the linebackers are going to deepen up a little bit. Everybody's going to be thinking wide, and that's the time to call a fullback hitting quickly up the middle, but Navy did not take the bait.
Second and 8, the ball on the 34. 20 to 10 is the score. Navy out in front, but Ben is in Navy territory now with a second and 8. On the end around, Rob Andrews ran right into the Navy man who was on the ground. Curtis Irby was right there blocking his path.
When you call a reverse and the defensive team does not take the fast flow, there's just no way of getting around the corner, and you can see that Navy defense was able to turn it back in and turn a reverse back in rather than letting it get outside. No chance for the play to succeed.
Iowa is leading Michigan at halftime, 10-3 in Ann Arbor. Here's the long one. Deep man has got it. Novoselsky fumbles the ball. He's got the ball. It's the helmet of Navy. It looked like the ball.
I thought the same thing.
Novoselsky goes all the way for the touchdown, his second of the day. And that's number 4 on the season, 39 yards.
And you don't expect to hit someone that cleanly when it's third down and long. Novoselsky is wide open, as you can see, behind everybody. And there goes the Navy helmet. I thought it was the ball too, Bill, but a great execution on the play by the quarterback, Krochikia, and a fine reception by Novoselsky.
Yeah, that was what we had seen on film, where basically I went and did a little quick out, and the safety came right up, and I went right past him. And Krochikia just laid it out perfectly. I grabbed it, dove into the end zone, and kicked the guy's helmet off. So, you know, you're watching it on film, it looks like I fumbled, and it actually was the guy's helmet. So I think his head was still in it, which is okay. You know, that all of a sudden we started thinking, okay, we're actually in this thing.
All right, here is Jim Grass to try for the extra point that would make it a 3-point difference. It's up and good, and it's 20-17, that score coming, with 11 minutes and 14 seconds to go in the ball game. How did that look to you, Rick Borzato, coming down there? You
see, I was right here in the end zone, Bill, watching that, and to me, it was a perfectly thrown football. He threw the ball into the inside of the receiver. The defender had no chance whatsoever, and they were in man-for-man coverage, Navy, that is. But Novoselsky just beat him down the field, and it was a perfect throw. There's no defense for the perfect pass.
Well, you could almost have caught Furley's helmet there rolling toward you.
I don't get into the action. I stay away from it.
All right. It makes it 20-17.
And
we'd like
pardon me.
We'd like to welcome stations KCBA-TV in the Salinas, Monterey area, and WTWS-TV in New London, Connecticut. They have joined our Freedom Football Network.
And Penn has moved very much back into this game. As we talked about, if the Quakers can play a reasonably good first half, they'll gain confidence, and then if they can make something happen at the start of the second half, which they did, the interception being the big thing that set up the first touchdown, and now the execution. This is anybody's game right now. Here's Jim Grass.
Low, kind of a wobbly kick, goes out of bounds. That'll be a 5-yard violation.
Out of bounds, that's a 7.
And Grass a little, I don't think too discouraged, because that's, he wanted to make that bouncing kick, hoping that the oval football will take a hop that might cause a fumble. And the scoring drive, beautifully executed. 5 plays, 50 yards, only 2 minutes and 4 seconds. And the pass was hit when it was third down, very close to 10, but beautifully executed by the quarterback and tight end.
Funny play about that drive is the trick play fizzled. You know, the deep reverse.
Yes.
And yet the straight old bread and butter paid off for him.
And it's difficult to get somebody that open on long yardage situations.
He kicks it away this time. Wallace. Got a little corridor down that left sideline, and it opened up for him enough to get through the 32 or 33 yard line. Next week, Navy will travel to Pittsburgh to engage the Panthers. And Pennsylvania will return home to Franklin Field to host Yale.
And Gary Tranquil is thinking, this time we have got to put a drive together. Penn has become very dangerous.
11 minutes to go in the ball game. Byrne on first down. Throws, it's complete to Curtis Brown. Again, up to about the 36-yard line. About 5 yards. Castanero making the stop, number 19.
Unusual to throw to the fullback. It's not unusual to throw to a tailback, but fullback has difficulty normally getting wide enough, quick enough. But you can see Brown taking over the ball, and then the rollout pass gave him time to run his pattern. Completion occurs. Byrne threw the ball right on target.
Chuck Smith puts his head down, but the opening close is pretty good. Mike Henley and Mike Lister, numbers 57 and 94, you know, on that stop. So that brings up a third down.
And Byrne is having a very good day throwing the ball. He's 12 of 24 for 144 yards.
Joe Brennan is apparently shaken up on the play. He's the heaviest lineman at 275. Comes from Brentwood, Tennessee. Red Romo escorting him off. Red's a fairly big guy himself. Look how he's dwarfed by Brennan.
This is a big Navy team. Height and weight.
Third and three. Quick toss, Chuck Smith. However, he leg drive puts him out of bounds at the 32. He had to, 37. He had to go to the 38.
Taking out of bounds.
That was a doggone good play there by number 21, Donald Wilson.
And you've got to credit the Penn defense for keeping Navy from making a first down in this critical situation. They're going to get possession of the ball again, which gives them an opportunity to move with their offense.
Good kick by Muick. Sends Flynn deep to the 26-yard line, and there's nothing there for him. Number 49 down there very quickly for the midshipman was Andre Stokes on the specialty team. That score is wrong, by the way. Pennsylvania has 17. On the 26-yard line. They're trailing here by 3. Plenty of time to go, 9:54. Well, Flynn was able to get outside, and I'll tell you, a couple of more steps and he might have gone. Got it up for a very quick first down at the 6. Well, now they're going to spot it back just a little bit. Very close to a full 10 yards.
A little bit of misdirection on the play. Marano went to the top of the screen before Flynn came back to the bottom of the screen, and that little fake in the backfield had the Navy defense moving one step in the wrong direction.
Close enough to measure this one. But you pointed out that this particular drive is very critical for both teams, even though should Penn score, let's say, in the average of 5 minutes, which is what these scoring drives have taken, there would still be 4.5 minutes to go in the ballgame. So, you know, it's anybody's guess here with only a 3-point difference.
Yeah, the difference in the Penn team, they have avoided penalties very well thus far in this half.
Look at that hole, and look how quickly it closed. It looked like it was absolutely that you could drive a truck through it, and all of a sudden, Enoch Blazes, a senior from Springfield, Illinois, number 75, slammed it shut.
He's a very fine nose guard. Centers have a very difficult time handling him.
You know, he almost quit the team. He was a defensive tackle, and he was discouraged a year ago, and he finally went to the coaching staff and said, look, you think I can play middle guard? I'm not getting anywhere as a tackle. And they said, sure, we'll put you there.
14 tackles unassisted, 13 assisted going into this game.
Nice draw play. Bruni gets through to about the 42-yard line. Well, the ideal thing here for the Quakers would be simply to grind it out minute by minute and get it down there within the last minute or so and push it in to score with no chance to return.
And to keep possession, they need to pick up the 5 yards on this play. Time of possession very close, as is the score.
Third down and a short 5. Ochikia bangs it in there to Flynn. He's got the first down, and he got his nose right on the midfield stripe. Things getting a little tense. Rick, what do you have?
Bill, both you and Bud said it'd be nice if Penn could control the ball on the ground. That's what they'd like to do, but it would be a lot easier if they had Rich Camizio in there, and it doesn't look like we're going to see him in the second half.
Well, I don't know how much easier. It certainly would cut down on Flynn being tired. He's going out now, I notice, and Bruni has come in place of him. One thing that Ed Zubrow has done all year long is to keep alternating those running backs and keeping them fresh. First and 10. Here's Bruni. And he gets it into Navy territory at the 47.
Again, that little bit of misdirection. Navy is reacting so rapidly defensively that little misdirection move takes them one step off balance.
Rick, I don't know whether you can tell or not, but it seems to butt into me that the hitting has been as hard today as we've seen in any game this year. Would you concur with that, Rick?
Yeah, I concur with it. They are hitting, they are squaring their shoulders and their pads to the ball carrier. A lot of hitting going on.
Well, you can hear the pads thumping up here. Second and 6. Flynn. Well, he was hit very hard as he got his nose right on the line by Mark Furley, and that just drove him back. But I think his point of progress was about the 43. So again, we have a situation where it'll be third down and about 2.
Those are tough yards to pick up consistently, but Penn has done a good job of it here in the second half.
Bruni comes in again for Flynn, who keeps alternating. Now they send Flynn back.
I think they like the experience on this particular play.
Well, you better get somebody out of there. You're going to have 12 men on the field. There goes Rob Andrews, and Krochikia calls timeout. There were only 6 seconds left on the 25-second clock, and he didn't want to risk a 5-yard stupid penalty at this point. 6:28 to go in the ballgame, and it's close. Bill Fleming, Rick Forzano, Bud Wilkinson. We're back here at the Navy Marine Corps Memorial Stadium in Annapolis. It's been quite an afternoon of football here. The people who turned out for it knew it was going to be a good battle, and they were not disappointed, and it is not over. 6 minutes and 28 seconds to go in the ball game, and it's 20 for Navy, 17 for Pennsylvania. First time these two teams have met since 1960, and I think Rick Marzano may remember the last meeting. Do you remember?
I coached in that last meeting when we won 27-0. But I also coached in the one the year before when Penn tied us 22-22 up at Franklin Field. Matter of fact, I should say we tied Penn. We were lucky to come out of there with a tie. It's always been a tough football game.
Now they go with a power eye. A different formation in the backfield. Third down and two. Oh, the left end broke. Novoselsky raised up, and that forced the Navy team to react to it, and it's going to cost the Quakers five, I believe.
And a very critical penalty one more time for Penn.
There it is. Watch the top of the screen here.
You can see the movement. He was not going to go out on a pass unless he was faking at that time. He was making a pass protection block, even though they were lined up in the power eye, which normally you would expect to be a strong running formation.
Third and seven.
And again, the penalties are very difficult for Penn.
Almost double. Well, the brigade is whooping it up a little bit here, and it may be one of the reasons Novoselsky jumped the last time, because they were yelling pretty loud. Might not have heard the signal. Ooh, that was close. Two Navy defenders in front of Scott's Spongio, and Curtis Irby, who's played himself quite a game in a reserve role today to Mike Heron at strong safety, was one of those two.
If they hadn't been so close, I think they'd have made the interception. Kind of interfered with each other.
Well, now what Pennsylvania will hope for is a fumble on this punt, as Fosnock will kick to Furley. Furley wasn't bashful on that. No fair catch. He just took it and drove his head right into Chris Wilkins. And so that'll be Navy's ball at the 50 to 20 yard line at 6:11. Now the question,
down.
I was going to say, Bud, what the strategy here is, if you can't move it on the ground, do you take that chance and throw? I mean, Byrne has been, what would you say, so-so today on the passes?
He's been a little better than that, but I think you are feeling totally that we have got to make a first down, and if it takes a throw to do it, we're going to do it because we must keep possession at this point in the game.
His completion record's okay, it's just that he's had two interceptions. Smith outside, and a good defensive play by Brad Hines, co-captain, the Rover number 46. That's the way to stop Chuck Smith. You've got to go low and get him around the ankles and just clamp them together.
Hines makes a very fine play. I think he was reacting up before the play was snapped, ball was snapped, because he was in the backfield when he hit Smith. And a safety man can't get there that quickly unless he is keying when the ball is snapped.
Handoff goes to Smith and wedges it out to about the 22-yard line. It's not going to be enough. Obviously, it's Fortner and Lista on the stop, and Pennsylvania playing very tenaciously here, trying to get this ball. They're only trailing by 3 points, and we have 5.5 minutes to go.
And the two first downs they made on their last possession, if they can stop Navy here, will give them good field position on the exchange.
Third down. About eight to go. Byrne is hit and sacked for the first time today. Hippensteel was the first man to hit him, and Lista put the clamp on him.
This is a fine defensive football team by Penn. They blitz well. They play the run well. They were burned by passes in the first half, but they're a very solid team.
Hippensteel, a junior from Tampa, Florida. Forcing Navy to give up the football here. And Flynn dances around and gets more out of it than you can believe. He had no right whatsoever to make 8 yards on that.
He's the only guy that thought he could. Nobody on either other team did.
He was absolutely stopped cold.
You can see he didn't have any room to run at all. But that's that stop, dart, stop. Dart again, go forward, keep moving, keeping your legs. And he got to be, had to be hit from behind to be brought down.
a total of 13, five easy ones, and eight of them were impossible. And good field position on the 42-yard line. Well, 4:26 to go. The Quakers now trailing by three. The fullback, Lorano, Joe Lorano, getting a couple. Chad Van Hulzen on the stop. Navy defenders talking it up along the line. They realize that they only have that slim three-point lead and that plenty of time on the clock against a very dangerous Pennsylvania team. And it's a team that's been flamboyant. I go back to a fourth down and one on the 7-yard line. Any other team in the country, you're looking for them to go in and get the first down. They go in and pass for the touchdown.
So play action faking on that play too, Bill.
Right. And here is Krochikia pumping short and going long. He has Novoselsky. He's got it on the 6-yard line, first and goal to go for Penn.
And once more, the play action just destroyed the Navy defensive secondary pattern. Looked like the ball carry was going to be the fullback, and then the short pump, and then the pop downfield. Receiver wide open because they had reacted so hard to the running fake.
Well, Novoselsky has been quite a star today, and I think he made up for that jumping back on the penalty that was rather costly. Power eye, Rooney in motion. Misdirection, Chris Flynn is hit at the 3-yard line and forced back, but it's second down and 3 yards to go for the touchdown that would put Pennsylvania out in front. We have 3 minutes and 9 seconds. The clock is moving.
And once more, the misdirection play, trying to keep the Navy defense and succeeding slightly off balance.
As we mentioned before, Pennsylvania plays in the 1AA division of the NCAA football scheme of things. And Navy, of course, is a 1A school. This is the only 1A division opponent that Pennsylvania meets all year long. And this is the game they pointed for. 2:40 to go. Second and three on the three. Krochikia goes left. He has a man wide open at the end line. It's Novoselsky for his third touchdown of the day. He beat Curley 1 yard inside the end line. And Pennsylvania has taken the lead.
Marvelous execution on that play. Once again, the fake, and you can see how pleased the receiver is. We watch Krochikia go back. He makes the running fake. He sent, throws, fakes, and then delivers the ball as he sees his receiver wide open. When he had that much time, Novoselsky could come back against the grain. Navy was moving to the opposite side, and he was wide open making the catch.
And here is Jim Grass. Has the kick blocked. Well, that could make a big difference. Instead of 24-20, it's 23-20, and Navy could possibly tie it up if they can't punch it in with 2:32 to go. So we are seeing quite a football game here today. And the Enoch Blazes was the one that got it, bud.
The way we felt about it going in, this team is get them in the second half alive, and they will have so much confidence they'll come back and play. And you can see how well Krochikia kept his poise, waited until the receiver could move against the grain to be wide open to make the reception for the score.
You could make a highlight film with Novoselsky and Krochikia today, couldn't you?
You surely could.
Three touchdowns that combination has produced.
And Navy has three timeouts remaining, which is important to them with the clock at 2:32.
And a man like Chuck Smith in the lineup.
You bet. I wouldn't recommend kicking to him.
It's been an uphill battle for Penn today. And I tell you this, the Quakers, even though they didn't have their starting left halfback, they certainly came on strong in this second half and played very well without it. Camizio was out with a hamstring, and although he wasn't seriously hurt, we saw him on the sidelines watching. He simply became a spectator. We'll be naming our Chevrolet players of the game here very shortly. It was voted on by Rick and Bob and myself. Here is the boot. Goes to Vernon Wallace at the 8. Wallace tears away from one man and fights his way to the 35. Fumbles the ball. It's still loose. It's covered by Penn.
He had a good idea, but not at this point in the game.
We got on them so quick in that fourth quarter. Yeah, they were down 30-20. They didn't really know how to react. Hence that fumble and that kickoff return. Why is that kid trying to pitch it? You know, there was a little bit of panic in their way they moved. And, you know, we came out, and that was it was a beautiful thing. So.
Wallace makes the catch very easily. He starts upfield, and he's determined to put something on the board. He fights. He gets away. It appears that he might break something, and then as he's in the grasp, he decides, I should lateral the ball. Matty Lytle, too, was not expecting it. Ball bounces free, loose, and Penn finally recovers.
And it looked like 97, Bill Coggle was the man who got it. First down on the 31-yard line, and Navy now is in deep trouble. Penn leading 23-20, 2:22 to go in the ballgame. Chris Flynn just dances and weaves much like a boxer and gets it down to the 30.
But the clock is the important thing. 2:11, 2:10.
I feel sorry for Wallace because he fought so hard to get that ball up there as far as he possibly could.
Mentioned Penn has been troubled by penalties, but Navy has just been killed by turnovers this season.
Minutes and 11 seconds to go in the ball game, and they're taking an extra tuck in that strap of the rib pads.
I think Navy took a timeout. And if you're the Penn coaching staff, you're thinking we need to make a first down while they use up their remaining timeouts, the Naval Academy, that is.
Well, Chuck Smith is hoping there that he gets a chance to get back in the game. That is a very dim possibility at this point. 23-20, Pennsylvania out in front by a three. 2 minutes and 11 seconds to go, and the ball is second down and about nine, just as you can see inside the 30-yard line.
There's no two-minute warning to give you timeout in college ball either, Bill. You don't get that extra timeout.
Well, the Service Academy is having a kind of a tough day today. Holy Cross defeated Army, Notre Dame over Air Force, and now Penn over Navy. And if this prevails, you can bet that the one thing that they'll all set their sights on is winning that Commander-in-Chief trophy to save the season. Ball down to the 29-yard line. Morano, the fullback.
And another timeout called by Navy.
What does that leave, one?
Yes. And they've been able to call the timeouts very quickly. 2 minutes and 11 seconds around the clock when Penn took possession after recovering the fumble in their own. There's still 2:05, so that's 3 seconds of play.
Let me give you some finals here. Yale over Columbia, 39-0. William & Mary over Delaware, 24-18. Lehigh over Princeton, 48-28. Penn State over Syracuse, 42-3. Temple over Virginia Tech, 29-13. It'll be interesting to see what Paul Palmer did today in his quest for the Heisman Trophy. Clemson over Duke, 35-3. Harvard over Dartmouth, 42-26. Cornell, 27. Brown, 9. Boston College, 41. Louisville, 7. Florida defeated Rutgers, 15-3. Notre Dame, 31. Air Force, 3. And Holy Cross, 17. Army, 14. Be an interesting matchup next week, and I think a rather even one, between Army and Rutgers at the Meadowlands, and we'll be bringing you that game at 12 Eastern. That's a change in our normal schedule from before the rest of this year. Third down. About eight to go for Pennsylvania. 2:05 to play in the ball game, and here is Krochikia back to pass. He goes deep again. He has a man. Touchdown. What a catch. Jim Bruni, who is listed as a third-string tailback, leaped up with three men, Bud, right there, and he got it for a 29-yard touchdown.
The running fake, I think, got the Navy defense coming one step forward because he's behind everybody here. He really does make a great catch, but he was in the clear behind everyone, and he made a marvelous reception, but Krochikia made a great, great throw under pressure.
Well, this Krochikia has been something today.
He's come on awfully strong, and this whole team has come on strong in the second half.
Four touchdown passes by Jim Krochikia. 29-20, this could be the 30th point by Jim Grass. It is up, and it's good. And Pennsylvania has really roared back here in this second half of play after trailing by 10. 1:59 to go. But the point is, even if Navy should get it and score, even with a two-point play, 10 points is a lot to make up in less than 2 minutes.
It surely is. And I have to admire this Penn team, because going into the game, and we talked about it early, that they thought that they could just be in the game when the second half started, and they did. Their defense was tough. Their offense was not totally effective, but they moved the ball a little bit. And when the second half started, they've come on strong, and they've gained momentum all of the time in the half. As we look at the touchdown pass again, and Bruni is behind the secondary thanks to the running fake. Navy moved up one step. He got behind them for the touchdown, and it's a three-play scoring drive. 30 yards thanks to the fumble recovery. Took only 23 seconds, but Navy spent two of their three timeouts before the scoring pass.
Well, this will be the first time since 1968 that Pennsylvania has started 5-0. If this keeps up for the next minute and 59 seconds, they're ranked number 17 in the country in Division I AA. I'm going to put my vote in for a lot higher than that.
I am too, Bill. And they're also certainly going to be the dominant factor in the Ivy League. It'll take an awfully good performance by one of their opponents in the Ivy League to beat them.
Big Ten score, a final. Michigan State defeated Illinois today, 29-21. And Michigan and Iowa are all tied, 10-10 in the third. Ball is picked up by Voss. Breaks outside. So the ball is placed down on the 49.
Anytime the kicker gets in on the tackle, you know the return has gotten further downfield than was expected. Grass has to come across and support and make the tackle on the play.
1:49 to go as time is running out on the mids. Out of bounds, Chuck Smith. He's got it at the 44-yard line as Donald Wilson bangs him out.
Good man to throw it to, but he's so much on the narrow side of the field when he caught that ball, he had no room to operate. However, he did get it out of bounds to kill the clock.
Auburn defeated Georgia Tech today, or is defeating Georgia Tech in the third, 31-10. Alabama over Tennessee. Ooh, look at this at halftime. 42-14.
Alabama's for real. No question about it.
Hippensteel knocking Smith out of bounds. Well, everything is predicated on getting that clock stopped. One timeout to burn, and they don't want to do it needlessly. Third down, about a foot. Over the center, and it's Mike Ray. He's out of bounds at the 22, and there's going to be a face mask penalty.
No question.
If it's inadvertent, 5 yards.
Ray's was wide open crossing the field on the play. I didn't think we'd see anybody that open when Penn is obviously expecting pass on every play as we see the face guard
not inadvertently
being grabbed, and that was for real. As we see Ray start downfield, he comes across the field. Oh, and a little pickoff play. The wide receiver came across and picked off the linebacker.
That moves the ball down with the penalty down to the 11-yard line. Mike Ray had the only touchdown last week against Air Force. 1:31 to go, and it's a first down for the midshipmen. They're trailing by 10 here.
They're thinking score, onside kick.
Absolutely. And score quickly here. Over the center, Mike Ray down to the 3-yard line. Let's see where they're going to mark it.
He's strong. Not big, 168 pounds, but leg drive.
Woo! Here's Chuck Smith. Barrels it close, down to the one. And the clock is stopped because I think they got the first down. I don't think they had to burn the timeout. 101.
This is a beautiful drive by Navy.
It's a first down. Alive. First and goal to go. They can get it in here and still only have less than a minute. Smith. Oh, he is so close. And give credit to the defense of the Quakers. They stopped the toughest ball carrier maybe in America right down on the 1 foot line.
Navy did take their last remaining timeout
right now. I say the toughest in America. I don't know that there's anybody that you could give the ball to who's more reliable on a couple of yard situation than Chuck Smith. Hard as nails.
Pennsylvania defense, though, their defensive planning is good. They bury the front. Rarely are they in the same front two successive downs. And the pattern where they line up against every offensive lineman, most teams are not used to playing against that.
Well, Byrne has come over to the sidelines. He's talked to Gary Tranquil. Now he jogs on back into the huddle. Pretty tense moment here for everybody, including the Pennsylvania Quakers, who fought their hearts out to a 30-20 lead. And the ball is on the 1 yard line with 51 seconds to go.
Navy out of timeouts.
Touchdown. All right, that stops the clock with 47 seconds to play. And it makes the score 30-26.
And it sets up a guaranteed onside kick.
Now the question is, would they go for two? Here's the situation. If they get the one, they could certainly go for the onside kick and have either Sunderland or Fundukas maybe tie it up. Or go for two, and if the same thing should happen, a field goal could win it. They're going to go for the 2 points.
I do remember the extra point. They went for two, and they came out in what we used to call Three Stooges, and we hadn't seen it all year, but we saw it the year before. And so we basically, you know, I looked over at Tom Flynn and then Brad Hines, and we had a defense from the year before. We just called one. I looked at it and fortunately played with them the year before, and I said, hey, I gave them the call, and they knew what we were doing. So we basically just sort of zoned it up with one guy jamming the front guy, and they all split all over the place and left me in the middle with the guy right there, and they threw the guy to the middle, and I was able to bat it down. But
Curtis Brown will be the setback behind Byrne. They send a wide out. Chuck Smith. Throw to Smith. No, it's thrown to the man curling inside, and it is incomplete. Fangmeyer was there. He either caught it or knocked it down, but the point is it did not complete the pass.
Byrne wanted to roll out enough to really fake the pass-run option. As we see the touchdown, easy into the end zone. They were closing inside gaps. Ball carrier able to roll it off to the outside. Find daylight, score standing up.
Now, coming up will be a play that they practice and practice and practice.
But you don't know how the ball will bounce.
The most fickle play in all of football, the onside kick. 47 seconds to go, 30-26.
You put all of your supposedly solid-handed people, people who can really are used to handling the ball, up within 8 to 10 yards of the restraining line so that you've got a lot of people there. And hopefully when the ball spins, if you are 10, it will spin to one of your men. And maybe you hope it's going to take a high hop. And we can get somebody to it before the Penn team can close on the ball.
47 seconds, Navy out of timeouts. It's 30-26.
And the scoring drive was 7 plays, 51 yards, but the important thing, it only took them a minute and 12 seconds. Here it is.
And it's smothered by Pennsylvania on the 47-yard line. And it is Dan McNally, number 14, who got his hands on the ball. There he is, and he's going to carry it off.
He said, I won the game by catching that baby.
So Navy is helpless here to stop the clock. And it looks like it'll be a very short ride back to Philadelphia for the Quakers of Penn, who have come here for the first time since 1915 where they've played at Annapolis, and they will carry home a victory. They have a four-point lead with 47 seconds to go, and there's nothing Navy can do about it.
One more snap, all it'll take. You can see everybody.
We did it. And Ed Zubrow is extremely happy, I'm sure, because he saw his team come from behind to do it. I mean, they were trailing by 10 points twice.
Their confidence kept building for them, though, and Kachikubi became a very excellent passer, given good protection, but the play action was the key.
Winding down now, we're in the last 10. And they will not get another play off. They could trot off the field at this point. It is all over. And Pennsylvania has made it 5-0. And this team is for real. Last time they defeated Navy was in 1953. Well, it's been a long 33-year wait, but it was worth waiting for, wasn't it?
Their game plan was excellent. And Ed is happy, congratulating Navy players.
He's looking for Gary Tranquil. And there's Hollinger, who got one of the Navy touchdowns here. Ed Zubrow is only 35 years old in his first year as a head coach.
Starting out 5-0 isn't bad, Bill.
Oh, yeah. And the Navy blue and gold. It's been a big afternoon for the Quakers of Penn. I don't know whether Ed can make his way down to you, Rick Borzani. Yeah, he's coming toward you, Rick, and I know you want to get a word with him.
Ed, congratulations. What a great win, I'll tell you. To come from behind like Ed, you've got to be so proud of your staff and your football team.
Thank you, Coach. I couldn't be prouder of the coaching staff and the football team. To come from behind, as you say, makes it even sweeter, and this is a tremendous day for Pennsylvania football.
Well, it's a great day for you. 35 years of age and winning football games like this, I think you're going to have a lot more wins this year. You have a fine football team. You're not a surprise to anybody anymore. You've come down here. You beat Navy on their own field. You said to me before the ball game, if we can stay in the game, the first half will be all right.
We really believed, and we talked with the team last night, that if we could stay within 7 or even 10 points at halftime, we could be in the football game and we would win the football game. But we just had to understand that we weren't going to win it all at once. We had to stay with them, play with them, get our feet on the ground, and I think our effort in the second half was tremendous. And I, as I said before, I couldn't be prouder of the coaching staff and the players of the University of Pennsylvania.
Well, thank you. We have your quarterback, Jim. We had Jim Cochia, but he is being...
Well, Novoselsky's down there. And,
I got
Rick,
him right now, Vince.
Rick, let me just say this, that Novoselsky Brent has been named the player of the game for the University of Pennsylvania. So that's quite an honor for him.
Well, you've been selected the player of the game, and I don't know why. You only scored 3 touches. He wasn't looking for anybody else other than you. It was a great, you were able to get yourself open. Did you feel this way before the game?
Yeah, Chick was actually looking for other people. I wasn't the primary receiver. The 2 passes I actually was, but we were reading their defense all day, and our primary receivers were getting covered, but they sucked up a lot, and we can get behind them, and we knew it, and we did, and Chick just threw the ball right there. He gets all the credit.
Well, they're having a replay of you catching the football, and I'm sure you're going to go back to Philadelphia and see an awful lot of that, and congratulations to you. You're an awfully fine tight end.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. As we mentioned, Brent Novoselsky is the player of the game, and $1,000 will be contributed by Chevrolet to the General Scholarship Fund of the University of Pennsylvania. In Brent's name today, scored 3 touchdowns and really was a spectacular star in this, what you might call, upset victory over Navy. And for the Navy side, well, who else but Chuck Smith, who played his heart out today. He had 34 carries, 123 yards, and a couple of touchdowns. It wasn't quite enough to surpass the Quakers, but once again, $1,000 will be contributed by Chevrolet to the United States Naval Academy Memorial Fund in the name of Chuck Smith and his performance here this afternoon. All in all, it was quite an exciting afternoon of football, and the Quakers have scored their first victory over Navy in 33 years by 4 points.